We are here on April 12, 2000 to interview Fred Gray. The interview is being conducted as part of the Oral History Project of the United States District Court for the Middle District of Alabama, a court before which Mr. Gray has practiced with distinction for 45 years. The interview of Mr. Gray is being conducted in the second floor courtroom of the Frank M. Johnson Jr. United States Courthouse, a courtroom in which Mr. Gray has handled many cases both before Judge Frank M. Johnson Jr. and before Judge Myron Thompson. Ernestine Sapp, who is an attorney practicing law primarily in Macon County, Alabama, and who is one of Mr. Gray's law partners, is conducting the interview.
Why were you named Fred David Gray?
Well, actually, my mother and her sister Julia were expecting at the same time. And they had an agreement between themselves that my mother, whose first name was Nancy, would name my Aunt Julia's baby, and Aunt Julia would name my mother's baby. Julia had a daughter. My mother named her Maxine. And Julia had, and mother, Nancy, had a son, me, and Aunt Julia named me Fred after her husband, whose name was Fred Johnson. That's the first name.
Okay.
The middle name is a little more difficult. Mom named me Fred Lee Gray, but at the time she was working, doing domestic work for a lady named Mrs. Betty Aldrich, who lived on High Street near High and Lawrence here. And she told Mom that she really thought that my middle name should be David. So my mother, out of respect for what Mrs. Aldrich wanted, she actually had my birth certificate amended, and I am Fred David Gray. That was not uncommon in those days. That was close relationship between white domestic workers or white black employees or white persons, and they had a kind of close family relationship. And Mom figured that if Miss Betty wanted me to be David, then she had no problem. So I'm Fred David Gray.
Did you have any nicknames that you were called growing up?
When I was in Montgomery, my nickname was Teddy. And when I go on the west side of Montgomery today, near Hill and Day Street and on Jeff Davis, a few of the old timers who are still there, they still call me Teddy. Now, I had another nickname when I was in high school in Nashville. I was named Bojack. It was a boarding school, and when I came in, someone ended up saying, there was a prize fighter from Alabama whose name was Bojack. And since I was from Alabama, for the next 3 or 4 years, I was called Bojack. So those are all of my nicknames.
What do your family members call you?
Well, it depends. If you deal with my wife or my former wife or any of the wives or any of us who are married, any of the three boys, all of the wives call us by our last names, Gray. And of course, others call me Fred, and then some people don't call me much of anything, just since I know they're talking to me.
Where were you born and when?
I was born in Washington Park on Hercules Street, in Montgomery on December 14th, 1930.
Now, you mentioned your mother, Nancy, but who were both of your parents?
My father was Abraham Gray. He was a carpenter, but he died when I was quite young. As a matter of fact, he died when I was 2. So from then until almost 1950, my mother, Nancy, took care of all 5 of us during that period of time. She later married in the late 40s.
Do you remember hearing your parents describe their lives at all?
Not really. Basically, my family was a very religious family. They tell me that my father, during his lifetime, would go on Sunday mornings and collect all the children and take them to Sunday school. During the old days on Ajax Street, which was the street right next to Hercules Street, they used to have a little church, and he used to take all the kids there. That was before my time. But we all grew up as members of the Holt Street Church of Christ on Holt and Columbia in Montgomery. And our basic life centered around home, school, and church.
Who's the oldest person you can remember in your family as a child?
Because the oldest person I can remember is my mother. And because I have one sister and three brothers.
And what are their names?
The oldest one was born Abraham Gray. His name now is Hassan Grahastani. The next one is Thomas Gray, who later became a lawyer and later retired as an administrative law judge here in Montgomery. My sister is Pearl Gray Daniel. She works at Alabama State. And my brother is Hugh Gray, who has a flower shop on Day Street here in Montgomery and has had for over 50 years.
Now, are all of your brothers and sisters here in Alabama, or are they pursuing their career paths somewhere else?
All of them are currently here, except my oldest brother, Hassan, is in Philadelphia, where he has lived for the last 30 or 40 years.
Who do you consider your most influential relative?
Well, I don't know about that.
They're all doing well.
All of them are influential in the sense that, at least as far as the siblings are concerned. And I realize I'm the youngest one, and I stay in my place. I do what I'm told.
How is the world now different from what it was like when you were a child?
Well, it depends on how you look at it. As a child growing up in the ghettos of Montgomery, as far as race relations were concerned, there were two worlds. There was the black community, and there was the colored community and the white community. The only relationship basically which existed between blacks and white was employer-employee relationship. If you take that then as compared to now, of course, things are altogether different, and the average youngster now has no knowledge of the fact that in those days everything was completely desegregated, from hospitals and doctor's office to elevators and office buildings and transportation and all other phases. And of course, to a great degree, a great deal of that has changed. In the area of employment, basically African Americans are colored, as we were called at some points, and then Negroes and sometimes colored. Basically, there were the menial jobs. The good jobs, basically, that people of color had in those days, if you had a chance to work on the railroad, and basically blacks were simply the laborers, and sometimes they would get to be firemen. There were some who worked in the post office, and then you had your teachers and you had your preachers, and that's basically it. The rest of it was, for all practical purposes, domestic work. Of course, now you have people of color who are doing everything that anyone else is doing.
Can you remember any of your childhood friends?
Yes, I had. There were really three of us, and we lived in the same community. Right down the hill from me was a boy whose name was L.H. His name was L.H. Carter. Now, his father worked for the railroad, and he was considered really, as far as economics is concerned, they were in very good shape. Then I had another very good friend whose name was Howard McCall, who lived up on Winford Street about three or four blocks from me. We were really very good friends, and what we used to do in the evenings, I lived on one hill, which was on Jeff Davis, just west of of Hill Street, because Hill Street now, Jeff Davis no longer go that far. And L.H. Carter lived down on Hill Street about a block away, and then Howard McCall lived on another hill up on Winford Street. So we used to walk between the three houses and then end up just about at L.H. house, and the two of us would go on to our respective homes.
What did you all do for recreation then?
Well, basically, we did a little playing of ball, and there were bicycles, and wasn't any real supervised recreation. We just would play with whatever we found that we could get our hands on.
Did you have a favorite toy? What kind of toys did you
Didn't have any favorite toy. There were two toys I always wanted, and my mother was never able to buy either one for
me. And what were they?
I wanted one of those little kitty cars, the kind you get in and you pedal. I wanted one. She did the best she could, but she never got enough money to buy me one. Secondly, believe it or not, I wanted a bicycle, and she was not able to buy me a bicycle. But I learned to ride other bicycles and got along okay.
What kind of books did you like? Did you read at that time? Did you read nursery rhymes or have nursery rhymes read to you?
Well, I'm sure early on there was the nursery rhymes, the usual things you do. And in elementary school, when I went to school, my first grade teacher happened to have been my aunt.
Mm-hmm.
And I got off, we didn't have Head Start then, but really I got off to a Head Start because you weren't supposed to go to school till you were six. And my birthday was in December. So the question was, and my mother had to go to work, and what was going to happen to me? All the other kids were in school. So my Aunt Sarah was a school teacher at then Lovely School on Jeff Davis. And she told Mom, just let him come on with the other children to school, and I'll just put him in my class. And I'm not going to register him initially and see how things go. So I ended up getting a head start the first year. And it developed that I was able to keep up with the other children. So she just finally went ahead and registered me. So I got off about a year ahead and going to the first grade.
Mr. Gray, you talked about the hard times of your family. Do you ever remember not having enough food to eat because times were hard for your family?
Well, we have always had whatever we had, there was enough of it. Whether it was grits, rice, neck bones, greens. And Mom would always have a garden, and she had a father who was a Methodist minister. His name was Jones, lived over on Beach Street. And he had a large area behind his house, so we never were hungry. And there were times that we did receive some form of, it wasn't called welfare then, but whatever it was called, you would end up getting certain commodities. We never thought of ourselves as being poor. Of course, we didn't have anything, but things worked out well.
Did you have any part-time job when you were in high school?
Well, of course, I left Montgomery quite early and went to Nashville to go to boarding school, and I did that when I was 12. And while in boarding school, I did, before I left, I had a job. I did. That was before I left Montgomery. I used to shine shoes in a barbershop that was on Greyhound Street, right behind Day Street in Montgomery. And my mother used to make pies. She was a very good cook. So she would make these small pies, and I would take them and sell them. They were usually sell for about 10 cents each.
And this was when you were about how old?
Oh, I was less than 12, about 11.
Okay. Now, what were the schools like that you went to?
Well, I went to elementary school, the first through the seventh grade, at the Lovely School on Jeff Davis. It was then a first through 12th grade. And then when I left and when I was 12, I went to the Nashville Christian Institute in Nashville, Tennessee, and went to high school there.
How did you get a chance to go to that boarding school?
Well, I was interested in being a preacher. And there was a Church of Christ school in Nashville that trained black boys to become preachers in the Church of Christ. And of course, we heard about it from our local preacher. And since I was baptizing cats and dogs and said I wanted to be a preacher, my mother said she would try to help me go to Nashville, and that's what happened, and that's how I got to the Nashville Christian Institute.
Would you explain to me, how did you get dubbed the boy preacher?
Well, what happened is shortly after I went to the Nashville Christian Institute, one of our pioneer preachers, whose name was Marshall Keeble, became president of the school. And the basic responsibility of the president, even like they are today for that matter, is to raise funds. So it's to raise funds and to recruit students. So he concluded that one of the best ways to do that was to take some of his students from the school, travel around the country, and go to various congregations, let the boy preachers preach ahead of him. Then they would take up a collection. First, the collection would be for the school, and then secondly, they would take up a collection that would help the boys with their tuition. And because of my speaking ability, I was one of the first boys that Brother Keeble took on one of his trips. He took many of them after that, but in probably about 1944, the first trip we took was from Nashville, going out west to Memphis, and then on down into Arkansas and Oklahoma and Texas and Louisiana, and back up through Mobile and through Montgomery and Birmingham and back to Nashville.
So you would preach before the main service?
Well, it'd be a part of the main service. Instead of having one sermon, you would end up having three. Normally, there would be two boys, and each one of us would speak only about 5 or 6 or 7 minutes. And then the other one would preach. We would switch it between the two boys, and then Brother Keeble would deliver the main message.
What was your favorite subject in school, and why was it your favorite?
Well, I was always interested in, to some degree, in history. I really never thought in terms of a favorite subject, but I guess if I had one, it probably would have been history.
Was this your easiest subject?
I don't know about the easiest. When I was in college, I ended up having a major in, a major in political science and a minor in mathematics.
Well, let's go to your college days. How did you choose what college you wanted to go to?
Well, of course, I lived in Montgomery. I'd finished high school in Nashville, and really I was kind of in a hurry to get out of high school, so I went to summer school one summer. Then I was supposed to finish in January of the next year. But I wanted to come back home and go to Alabama State. Alabama State was on a quarter system, and their quarter started right after Thanksgiving, matter of fact, the first Monday in December. So I had the question of how in the world could I get enrolled in Alabama State in December and not scheduled to finish high school until January.
And were you still out of state then?
I was still in Nashville.
Okay.
And I discussed it with my principal, and he told me that, well, if I was able to get my teachers to give me my exams when we left for Thanksgiving holiday, then he would let me graduate. And I told him I had already been admitted to Alabama State conditioned upon my finishing high school. The teachers gave me the exam because I'd already talked to them before I talked to the principal, and I enrolled in Alabama State December of 1947.
Who was who were some of your more influential teachers, and why were they special to you?
Well, there were two teachers who were particularly special. One, Thelma Glass, she still lives. She lives out on Edgemount, a street right up the street from where I later lived after I married. But it happened that Mrs. Thelma Glass began her first year of teaching, the same time I started my first year of college. I didn't know that then. She didn't tell us that until some time later, but she taught me English. Then later on, she taught me history, and later on, she taught me geography. And our class thought a great deal of Mrs. Glass. She told us and gave us some good pointers about how to study. And when we were seniors, we selected her as our advisor. The other person who was very special to me was J.E. Pierce. Mr. Pierce taught political science at Alabama State. He was very interested in registration and voting. He did a great deal of work in compiling these statistics. We didn't have very many blacks who were registered at that time. We started talking, and he thought that the legal profession would be a good profession for me to enter. And of course, I told him I was really interested in preaching and teaching. And then as I looked around and as I was working then for the afternoon newspaper and lived on the west side of town, Alabama State was on the east side, the advertiser company, which was the company that owned the newspaper then, the Alabama Journal in the afternoon, was downtown. So I used the bus system from as little as twice a week, twice a day, to as much as six or eight times a day. And I did observe many of our people were mistreated and were not treated very courteous on the buses. And I'd seen some altercations between bus drivers and riders. I never had any problems, but I had seen it. And I felt that the bus situation was a very crucial one and conditions just shouldn't be the way they were. I also observed at that same time, it became very clear to me that everything in Montgomery was segregated based on race. And I knew that if a black person had a problem with a white person, there were very few, if any, lawyers in Montgomery then who would handle those cases. So I began to decide that maybe in addition to being a preacher and maybe a teacher, that I would begin to look at the legal profession as a profession.
Now you mentioned the Montgomery Advertiser. What were you working for the Montgomery Advertiser when you were in college?
Yes, I did. At that time we had two newspapers. Both of them were owned by the Advertiser. The Alabama Journal was the afternoon paper. And my job was circulation. Well, I started out as a news carrier of Route 602, which is the afternoon route on campus of Alabama State. I knew the man who at that time was a manager, he was a student, and he told me he was graduating the next year. He said, well, Fred, if you accept this route, do a good job with it, I believe I can get you the job as a manager. I accepted the Route 62 and became known as the paper boy on campus. And then he graduated the next year and I was able to get the job. So I was in charge of about 13 newspaper carriers on the east side of town. Of course, that was segregated too. There were two black districts, one on the east side and one on the west side. And then there were some 8 or 10 other districts that were white throughout the city.
So you were riding the bus to deliver to supervise your carrier?
No, I was really riding the bus to go from Montgomery to downtown to the office or over on campus. And my work really in the district was basically walking because it was all on the east side of Montgomery. But I would get the bus to go downtown to check in and to go downtown to check out. And then if I'm going to go to the libraries in the evening, I'd go back on the east side and then home in the evening.
What type of school activities did you participate in college?
You mean extracurricular activities?
Yes.
Well, it wasn't much time for me to engage in any really extracurricular activities because I would begin working about, supposed to go to work shortly after 2, and then I worked from 2 until about 8, so there wasn't much time.
Did you ever serve with the student council or with the student body? government?
I may have been. I was not president of. I did run for president of the senior class, but I didn't win. Matter of fact, Vernon Crawford, who later became a lawyer down in Mobile, beat me out for the presidency of the senior class. I was on the Student Government Association Council.
Now, with all of your part-time work and the class load, what did you do about studying? What were your study habits then?
Well, I could even work in some studying between work, because frequently when the carriers would go out to deliver their papers, unless I had some special things to do, between then and the time they would come back in the event there was some adjustment to be made in their paper deliveries the next day, I did have some time that I could do some other things.
Were you ever given any special awards for your studies or any school activities in college?
Not really. I did graduate with honors.
And what year was that?
That was in 1951. There was something that happened during my junior year in college that really made me decide to go to law school. And I alluded to part of it. But as a result of seeing situations as they existed on the buses, seeing how people were mistreated, realizing that everything was segregated and that there simply was little or no justice, I felt that black people or colored people or Negroes in Montgomery in the 50s, in addition to needing preachers and teachers, needed some lawyers. And I made a secret commitment, one that I didn't tell anybody about fully for some 35 years. And that commitment I made during my junior year was that I was going to become a lawyer. And the only way I could become a lawyer would be to leave Alabama, because I could not attend the University of Alabama Law School because of my color. Come back, pass the Alabama bar exam, and destroy everything segregated I could find. That was my secret commitment.
How did you select your law school?
Well, I wanted to go to a good small law school, and there were a lot of good law schools across the country. But I also needed to go to some place where I could find employment. And I found that in Cleveland there was a good law school, Western Reserve University, an old school, been in existence for a long time. And Cleveland in the early 50s was known as a place where you could find employment. And many blacks who lived in Alabama at that time migrated to Cleveland and to Detroit and other areas up in that part of the country in order to get employment. So I decided and received information about Western Reserve. And I later found out when I looked at their catalog that all of their classes at that time, they would begin at 8:30 in the morning and they were out by 12:20. So I felt that with a class schedule falling with that way, it would give me more flexibility in terms of being able to, one, seek employment and have time to study. And that was one of the reasons I selected Western Reserve.
Well, why didn't you go to the University of Alabama?
Couldn't go because of my color. Same reason I couldn't go to the high school in Montgomery, and the same reason I couldn't attend the University of Alabama when I was in college and had to go to Alabama State.
Were there any special arrangements made for students who wanted to go, black students who wanted to go to the University of Alabama Law School?
Yeah, that was a case that was decided, I think, in 1939, U.S. versus Gaines, which in effect held following the case of Pleasant versus Ferguson, which was the case involving transportation of a man going through Louisiana that held that as long as Louisiana had separate facilities for blacks, then they could segregate people based on race. Following that, the Gaines case held that in the field of education, you could continue to segregate the races as long as the education afforded blacks was substantially equal to that of white. Pursuant to that, Alabama and many of the southern states had a plan where if the University of Alabama or Auburn offered graduate courses or professional courses where white kids could attend, and those courses were not offered at the black schools, Alabama State, Alabama A&M, or Tuskegee, then they would contribute a portion of their tuition, room, and board so that they could go out of the state and receive an education. And it was that form that I used, and it was on a reimbursement basis.
So the state of Alabama would pay a portion of your law school training at Western Reserve?
That's what it did.
Okay. Did you like Western Reserve?
It was a very good school, and of course I went there solely with the purpose of coming back. So I then found out as soon as I got there, I thought I needed to start preparing to return. So I tried to find out the area of law that I felt would be different in Alabama, and I was told that Title VII was the procedure section that I would probably have more difficulty with. So I asked the librarian to order me a section of Title VII of the Alabama Code, and I ended up outlining that whole code during my spare time. Each research project I had in law school, I did it on a project involving Alabama law. And every day as we would discuss each case and would decide the point of law, I found out whether or not the point of law we were discussing, whether Alabama followed that point or what Alabama's position was. And I did that on a day-to-day basis because I knew also that there was no bar review course that I could attend in Alabama, even though there was one at Jones Law School here, but I couldn't attend it because of my color.
How did you get your finances for the supplemental finances over and above what the state of Alabama paid you for going to school to Western Reserve?
Well, of course, I had to pay my tuition and room and board before I could get anything from Alabama. And my brother, who at the time was a businessman when I was going to school, we went to the then First National Bank here to try to borrow some funds, and we couldn't. My mother borrowed what she could. And then finally, I got in school by paying a portion of my tuition, room, and board. And at the end of the first semester, we had finished all of the courses, had taken the exam. I was called into the office by the secretary and told that I couldn't find out my results because I hadn't paid my tuition. It just happened, and that was a very miserable feeling.
How did you get around that?
Well, the Lord sometimes helps those who can't always help themselves. At least he provides a way. Believe it or not, the same day I went home, I had some mail. And there was a letter from my college fraternity's home office, the Omega Psi Phi fraternity. Many months before, I had applied for a scholarship that the fraternity had. It was only a $250 professional scholarship. And sure enough, I had been granted it, and there was a check in the mail for $250, which was more than enough to pay the balance of my tuition. I immediately went to the office, the finance office, paid it, went to the law school. They posted my grades, and behold, out of the 120 students who were in that class, and I was only one of six African Americans in a class of 120, and we had there students who had finished all of the prestigious universities in the country, at least a lot of them. And I had an inferiority complex. I had never been in an integrated situation before. But I did pretty good. I was 19th out of 120.
Tell us about your friends. Who, you said there were about six of you there in the class?
Yeah.
And did any of those end up being good friends with you or coming back to Alabama?
Actually, the six of us who were of color in law school all became lawyers. One, a fellow named Ishmael Childs, was from Talladega and had been a principal there. and had decided that he was going to have a new career. He ended up resigning his principalship, took his family, and moved to Cleveland and started reserve. He went the first year, then he transferred to Cleveland Marshall. He said that the pace and the work at reserve was a little too fast for him, and he had to take care of his family also. But he became a lawyer and still practices there. Another fellow named Rudy Henderson lived in Cleveland. He practiced there, then later had a career in Washington, D.C. With the Foreign Service and with the State Department. One young man, my roommate, was Pullman Bracewell, who was from Liberia, West Africa. He later went back to West Africa, went back to Liberia, and rewrote the code for that country, and later became chief counsel for Firestone over there. Mm. The other one was a fellow named Carl Chancellor, who lived in Cleveland and who later became one of the lawyers for the Cleveland Illuminating Company. And the other one was a fellow named Derek Bell, who was from the southern part of Ohio, and he became a lawyer, recently retired from there, and he now lives in Las Vegas. So we all were able to get through.
Did you work any at all while you were in law school?
Oh, yes. I had to work. I had several jobs, but it boiled down finally to my doing two jobs. What I tried to do was to work as little as I could during the school year, and then work at night during the winter. I had two jobs during the summer. One, I worked at Republic Steel at night from 11 until 7. And then during the day, I worked for a dry cleaning company, picking up and delivering dry cleaners. It ended up that the picking up and delivering dry cleaners was very good for me, because I then set up a concession during the school year at Western Reserve, so I was known as the laundry and dry cleaners man on campus, and I ended up doing a lot of the kids' laundry and dry cleaning, so it ended up being quite productive.
Were there any fads during your time that you can remember vividly?
Didn't have much time for fads. I worked and went to law school and went to church. That was it.
How old were you when you started law school?
Started law school, I was 20. Yes, I was 20.
Okay. Can you name any good friend that you've known for the longest period of time, maybe through all of your years in law school up until present?
I told you about my two childhood friends. L.H. still lives in California. Unfortunately, Howard died about 10 years ago. He later went ahead, and shortly after he had received a doctorate degree, he died. Back in high school, I guess the person who I've known the longest was a fellow named Obi Eli, who lives in Cleveland, still lives in Cleveland, and who's in the wrecking business there, and we're still friends.
How did you meet the person that you would later marry?
Bernice, who was then Hill, I had known even when I was in high school, because she attended the Gale Street Church, which was one of our churches of Christ on the east side of town, when I was attending Holt Street on the west side. But we renewed our acquaintance after my first year in law school. I came home, and I was going to only be home for about 3 weeks. Stopped by the newspaper office and found out that the same boss I had was still there, that they had a vacancy at my old job. Excuse me. So he asked me if I would go and work for as long as I would be here. And they needed some newspaper carriers, so I was out in what really is now Victor Tulane Projects on Smite Curve off of High Street. And I saw a young lady sitting on the porch that I knew, and it was Bernice Hill, whom I had known from church. I went there to talk to her about the possibility of if she knew some boys who might want a newspaper route. She gave me the name of several of them. One of them we ended up employing, and I just decided to keep coming back to see her. And that's the way it started.
Right. When and where did you get married?
Well, we got married right in the middle of the bus boycott on the 17th of June in 1956. Of course, Bernice was working in my office before we got married, and everything then was, I was everybody's lawyer. The boycott was in full force. We had already had the arrest of the almost 90-some people, including Dr. King. We had tried Mrs. Rosa Parks' case. We had filed the case of Browder versus Gale. So right in the middle of all of this, I got married. And it was a typical boycott wedding.
Why do you call it a boycott wedding?
Well, because it was right in the middle of the bus boycott. Because we didn't call it a boycott then. We called it a protest. But the protest started on the 5th of January of December in 55. We got married some 6.5 months later. And we were having mass meetings in connection with the protest every Monday night. And my home congregation, the Holt Street Church, we had we're in a building program. And it torn down the existing building, was about to build a new one. So we were actually married at the Holt Street Baptist Church, which was right a block up the street, which was the same place where the first mass meeting started. And for the wedding, they tell me people started coming about 3 o'clock in the afternoon for a wedding that was around 5.
Who was there?
Everybody was there. We invited everybody. We just felt that since I was everybody's lawyer, everybody was interested in what we were doing. So we simply says, whosoever will come.
Did you have a honeymoon?
Well, I didn't have any money for a honeymoon because those cases in those days, you didn't get many fees, but I was the delegate to the National Convention of the NAACP, which met that year in San Francisco.
And what year was that?
That was 1956.
Okay.
So, as the delegate, they did defray expenses out there. So I came up with the idea that maybe we would end up having a combination. I'd go out there, I'd get married, and I had a little 54 Ford. And so as soon as we got married, we went to Cleveland to have a reception. And I had a stepbrother whose name was Curtis Arms, and he was married. So Curtis and his his wife and Bernice and I got in the little Ford. We went up to Cleveland to the reception. Then we drove that Ford from Cleveland to San Francisco to the NAACP's convention. While in San Francisco, I ended up getting a letter from my draft board telling me that they had changed my draft status and that I had to report out to H&R Point for the purpose of having a physical examination to be prepared to be inducted into the Army. So we had to cut even the convention short to drive back to Montgomery and be here in time to be examined for the Army.
Now, before we get to your military service or about that, how would you describe Bernice?
Oh, Bernice was a very charming young lady who was very, she had just finished, she finished Alabama State in May, and we got married in June, and she had taken the usual secretary commercial courses and had been working in my office even before that time. And she was a very considerate, mild, low-keyed person.
What did you admire most about her?
I admire everything about it.
How long were you married?
40 years.
And Bernice passed away in what year?
On the 18th of March, 1997. She died unexpectedly.
And how many children did you all have together?
We have four children.
What are their names and birthplaces and ages?
Deborah is the oldest one, and she's working now with our Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center, which is a center in Tuskegee that's designed to point up the contribution of the three ethnic groups that have made contributions in the field of human and civil rights in this area: Native Americans, Americans of African descent, and Americans of European descent. The next oldest is Vanessa Gray Taylor. She is a paralegal in our law office. She works for Walter McGowan, one of our law partners.
And she's married with children.
Yes, she's married and has two children, our only grandson, and she has a daughter. Fred Gray Jr., who's married to Bridget, he also practices law with us. And she works as a law clerk in our office. And they have two daughters. And the youngest one is Stanley, and he's married to LaWanda, and they have a daughter.
And Stanley practices.
And Stanley practices with us also.
What is the funniest thing that you remember any of the children doing when they were growing up?
Well, I don't know. I guess one of the things, Stanley was always a rather interesting little fellow. He's the youngest one. But I remember we were living not in the house where we live now, but a house we built in Bull Subdivision. And all the bathrooms, it was a split-level house, and all of the living quarters, bedrooms, were on the upper floor. And there were four bedrooms, because our bedroom, and then there was a guest room, and then a bedroom for the girls and for the boys. There was a bathroom off of the hall, and the children would usually use that all the time. And then there was our bedroom, and then there was a bathroom through our bedroom. So one night when Stanley was very small, for reasons best known to himself, he decided not to use the bathroom in the hall, but came through our bedroom, to the bathroom. And so on his way out, his mother said to him, says, "Stanley, can you find your way out?" He says, "Yes, mother, I found my way in." So that's probably one of those little tricks that I always remember about Stanley.
Now, attending an out-of-state law school, how did you study to pass the Alabama Bar?
Well, as I indicated to you earlier, I really started preparing for the Alabama Bar on a day-to-day basis to find out what Alabama law said. So all I really needed to do initially was to go back through each one of those courses that I knew was going to be on the bar, review my notes, and see what the Alabama rule was on the various points. In addition to that, I did take the review course in Ohio, which was a third bar review course. And I had also written early on during my career to Judge Walter B. Jones, who was then operating and the owner of Jones Law School, and I inquired about what I would need to do in order to prepare for the bar. And he referred me to several articles in the Alabama Lawyer and told me about the Title VII of the Code and some other information, and I followed his instructions and received that information. And when I left Cleveland, I stopped by Columbus and took the Ohio bar exam. Then I came home, and for the next 6 weeks, I just studied everything I could find, preparing myself for the Alabama Bar. And that's the way I did it.
And this was what year?
This was in 1954. I finished in May, took the Ohio Bar in June, took the Alabama Bar in July, and was in misery thereafter. And we knew that on a certain date, we could call Columbus and find out whether we had passed the Ohio Bar. And if I had, I'd have to go up there to be sworn in. So after having taken both bars and not knowing the results of either, I was really disturbed, and I told my mother I'm going to get a bus and just start going toward Cleveland and hope I pass. And I stopped in Nashville, where I'd gone to high school, and one of my high school schoolmates, a fellow named Robert Woods, lived in Gallatin, Tennessee. And, you know, Gallatin, Tennessee at that time was the home of the Randy Record Shop. And if you knew anything in those days about rhythm and blues, there was a Randy Record Shop in Gallatin, Tennessee that Gene Noble was the disc jockey on. So on that day that I could call to find out about the exam, I was with Robert Woods. There was a phone outside, a pay station phone outside a Randy Record Shop. I went, I called Columbus, and they told me that I had passed the bar. So I was a happy creature. And I told Robert goodbye, and I got a bus and went to Cleveland and was sworn in. And while I was there being sworn in, I got a phone call from my mother and told me that I had a letter from the Alabama bar. And everything just kind of fell down because I didn't know what was what. So I said, well, what you want me to do with it? I said, I want you to open it. She opened it and read it to me, and behold, I had passed the Alabama bar. So I was now ready to leave Cleveland and come back to Alabama and start carrying out that secret commitment that I had made.
And what was that commitment that you made?
And that commitment was to pass the Alabama bar, become a lawyer, and destroy everything segregated I could find. Still didn't tell anybody about it. I told only my mother, and only told her part of it. I told her, finally, when I was admitted to law school, and this is going back a little bit, and I didn't even tell her I'd applied, so I just took it one day and eased to her the letter of acceptance. And she read it. She says, all right, Mr. Smart, now that you've been accepted, where are you going to get the money from? And then she went out and started to help to try to find the money. But I came back. And the other part of it, about that part of it, was I had an advisor at the Reserve, a fellow named Professor Sonfield, who thought I could develop into a good lawyer, but thought I should not come back to Alabama because I wouldn't be given an opportunity. And I told him I appreciated that, but the only reason I was in law school was to come back to Alabama to practice. And he said, well, let me tell you something. If you must go back, don't be afraid to divide a fee with a lawyer who has more experience than you. I remembered that. And if you look through Bus Ride to Justice on every one of those cases that I have handled and all the cases I have handled in this court, there has always been some other lawyers there. And in many instances, it wasn't that I felt I was incapable of doing it, but I recognized the issues were so important that we need the very best that we could get. But I did not tell him what I intended to do once I got back, other than just to practice law.
And how did you get started in practicing law here in Montgomery, Alabama?
Well, I knew there were very few options. Now, when I left to go off to law school, there was no black lawyers here. When I came back, of course, Charles Langford was here, who now practices with us. But we were unable, and I talked to Charles about the possibility of practicing with him, but Charles' practice was pretty meager too, and we didn't get together. Finally, I had met Reverend S.S. Say, who then was the Secretary Treasurer of the Home Mission Department of the ALMD Zion Church, which was a national office. He had an office downtown, 113 Monroe Street, upstairs over Sears Auto Shop. And I talked with him about some space that he was not using. And he told me that I could use the space. If I had any money, I could pay him $25 a month. If I didn't, don't worry about it. And of course, he was Solomon Say's father. And at that time, Solomon was off in law school.
What was your daily routine then? You went into this office that Mr. C had let you have.
I set up an office in some space that was in the rear of where the upstairs where he was. And, of course, as a young lawyer, you know, you couldn't advertise in those days. So I did have an open house. But if you're going to be a lawyer, you need to have some books. But I didn't have any books and didn't have any money to buy any books. But I had met Mr. Clifford Durr, and I had met his nephew, Nesbitt Elmore. And what I ended up doing, and they had an office on Moulton Street. He ended up, I borrowed Mr. Elmore's books, took them to 113 Monroe Street when I opened my office that Sunday, so that when people came in, they'd be able to see some books and it looked like I'm a lawyer. And then on Monday, I took his books back. And that was the beginning of opening my office.
What did you do with the books after the reception was over?
Oh, well, the next day, I returned them to the owner. I just thought it would look nice to have an office that looked a little like a lawyer's office. And you'll probably find later on some of either the newspaper reporters or someone else some years later who were describing, or some of the persons who attended, they talked about my bare office. And it was quite a bare office.
Now, you mentioned Clifford Durr and several other persons. Who were the persons that had the most positive influence on you in that period in time of your life when you started your practice?
Well, of course, I have to begin really with E.D. Nixon, because E.D. Nixon was a family friend of ours. His wife went to our church. He was the person in Montgomery who was working in the field of civil rights, had been president of the NAACP, was a Pullman car porter, and if anybody in those days had a problem, anyone who was really working in the field of civil rights, E.D. Nixon was that person. So I had been talking to Mr. Nixon while I was a law student, because I had to receive affidavits from five lawyers who had been practicing for at least 5 years in order to register as a law student. And I did not know five lawyers. Matter of fact, when I went off to law school, I didn't know one lawyer. And I knew Mr. Nixon, being the person he is and dealing with lawyers and with people with problems, he would know. So I had talked with him, and he had helped me to identify some lawyers. And included in those lawyers were Clifford Durr and Nesbitt Elmore. Mr. Elmore also, Mr. Durr, was very instrumental in helping me when I would have a legal problem, whether it was in the field of civil rights or whether it was just plain, any just plain problem that a lawyer, a young lawyer just out of school needed to talk to somebody about. He really was that. So he played a very pivotal role in the growth and development of my career from that point of view. And of course, E.D. Nixon, from a layman and introducing me to people and recommending me to people, played an important role. And then there's another person who played a major role, and that was Reverend S.S. Say. Because, see, Reverend Say's office was right there. And I didn't have a father for all practical purposes, because my father had died, and because my stepmother remarried. But when she remarried, I was away in school.
Mother remarried your stepfather?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And his name was?
Arms. His name was Benny Arms. So on a day-to-day basis, I would see Reverend Say and his wife, who worked in his office. And of course, Bernice was working in my office, so he really was a real mentor in terms of just giving me good fatherly advice and good instructions and in recommending clients. The first client I had that I made a fairly decent fee, first wrongful death case I had, Reverend Say recommended the people to me. It was a wrongful death case down in Greenville, and Max Cannon School was a school of the ALMD Zion Church. So those are some of the persons who played roles in my early development.
Now, moving along into your evolving career, you...
Well, let me go back and mention one other person early on, too, and that is Rosa Parks, because Mrs. Parks worked... She was the secretary to the branch of the NAACP. She was a youth director, and I wasn't too far out of the youth group. She worked downtown Tuskegee, downtown Montgomery, at the then Montgomery Fair, which was just a block and a half from where I was. And she used to, during lunchtime, and of course at this time everything is segregated, so we would usually bring our little lunches. So when she would have her lunch break, she would usually come down to my office and we would all sit down and talk about whatever there was to talk about.
Now, you mentioned Mr. Durr would help you with different types of problems. Was this the beginning of your practice specialty? How do you develop your specialty?
Well, I never thought about a practice specialty. I knew the reason I went to law school was to come back and to destroy everything segregated I could find. So I knew that the area of law that I was primarily concerned about really doing was civil rights work, but I also knew in order to make a living as a young lawyer, any legal matter that came by, if I thought the person had a cause of action, I would do my best to help to solve it.
Now, a few minutes ago, you mentioned a couple of African-American lawyers that were practicing in Montgomery when you started practice. Could you tell us what other African-American lawyers were here practicing in Montgomery besides Charles Langford?
Now, at the time I came back, Charles Langford was the only African-American lawyer who was practicing here. Okay. Now, there were some other African-American lawyers who were in the state. As you know, Arthur Shores, who really was the dean of black lawyers of this state and who had been a lawyer for many, many years before I came along and had been handling civil rights cases for many years. He was in Birmingham, and he was one of the lawyers that signed an affidavit for me, both as a law student and as to take the bar. Also at that time was Ozell Billingsley, Peter Hall, Oscar Adams, David Hood, and there was another African-American named Henley, Charles Henley, who did not practice, but he had a law license. He was the Grand Master of the Masons of Alabama. And that was all of the lawyers, black lawyers in the state at that time.
Can you, Mr. Gray, describe for us the series of major events that occurred in Montgomery, Alabama, your first 18 months of practice that changed your life and perhaps the landscape of America?
Well, there were a lot of things happened in Montgomery from, let's begin with when I returned to practice law. I was licensed to practice in September of 1954.
And how old were you then?
23.
Okay.
Because I would have been 24 in December.
Okay.
On the 14th. Shortly thereafter, and I believe it was around October of 54, Martin Luther King Jr. was installed as pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. That in and of itself would not have been a very important event because Dexter Avenue was not a large Baptist church for blacks in this area, and it was basically a church of the more affluent blacks, more affluent African Americans. And they had just had a rather interesting pastor who was Reverend Johns. So for them to get a new pastor in and of itself but for what happened subsequent, would not have been of any real consequences. But later on, The next real event that I can recall, on the 2nd of March, I believe, 1955, I represented Claudette Carvin. Now, Claudette Carvin was a 15-year-old African-American high school student who was going to Booker Washington High School, which then was on Union Street, near High. She lived in the Kings Hill area, northeast, up toward off of the upper Wetumpka Road. She rode the bus like all of the kids who were going to high school out there, and they were going to Booker Washington. They rode not a school bus, but the public transportation. One afternoon on the 2nd of March, she was en route home, had gotten on Capitol Heights bus at the square, and went one block to Commerce and Bibb, and was asked to get up and give her seat to a white man. Claudette did not get up and give her seat. The police came and asked her to give up her seat. She still would not. They literally drug Claudette off of the bus. They arrested her, charged her with being a delinquent, and I represented Claudette. And of course, Mr. Nixon and the whole black community were told about this incident involving Claudette. It's a lady named Joanne Robinson, who was a teacher at Alabama State, who was from Cleveland and who had had a problem on a bus in Montgomery, back in 1948. A very humiliating experience that she'd never forgotten. And she was chairman of the Women Political Council. And they had began keeping records since 48 of incidences that had occurred on the buses. And I talked to Mr. Nixon. So the black leadership went and had a meeting with the city officials and the bus company officials about Claudette Carvin. And there were statements made at that meeting, and there was thoughts made, there were expressions that if conditions simply were not changed, then maybe we just need to stay off of the buses. We were assured that conditions would be better, that incidents like that would not happen again. So I represented Claudette in the juvenile court of Montgomery County. They found her to be a delinquent child, but placed her on unsupervised probation.
So was that your first case?
I wouldn't say that was my first case.
Okay.
But this was the first case involving race. And I really saw this as an opportunity to file a suit to end segregation on the buses. Because even as early as this, the Interstate Commerce Commission had outlawed segregation on interstate travel. So that was another event, her arrest. Then the next major event that occurred was in October of 1955. Frank M. Johnson, Jr. was sworn in as judge of the United States District Court for the Middle District of Alabama. This is some 6 weeks before Rosa Parks' arrest. December 1st, we had Rosa Parks' arrest. And then there was a series of meetings that took place and things behind the scene that occurred between then and the time that she was tried on the 5th of December. And of course, as a result of her being convicted, we had the mass meeting at the Holt Street Church. We had the beginning of the bus boycott. We had the selection of Dr. King to be the spokesman, Mr. Nixon to be the treasurer of this new organization known as the Montgomery Improvement Association, Reverend Abernathy to be a vice president, and Mr. Rufus Lewis, who was working in the field of registration and voting, to be chairman of the Transportation committee, and I was selected as the lawyer for the group. The next major event that occurred was when we couldn't resolve the issues between the black community and the city and the bus company officials. A lawsuit was filed that I filed in this court, the first case that I filed in this court. Stylob was Aurelia Broder and others, and some of the others included Claudette Carvin's parents and Claudette as a plaintiff in that suit, versus Gail and others. And Gail then was the mayor of the city of Montgomery. So that suit was filed. And subsequent to that, we convened because we were challenging not only the city ordinance of the city of Montgomery, but the state statutes. We were claiming to be unconstitutional. We had a three-judge district court. And a couple of months later, the three-judge district court held that the city ordinances and the state statutes to be unconstitutional. So you had a span of about 18 months from the time I was admitted to practice in September of 54 until the decision in Browder versus Gale, which was probably in the spring of 55. That would take you nine to 56. You had those series of events, and those series of events, really, when you put them all together, they have really changed not only the landscape of this nation, it has helped to change the landscape of the world.
Now let us talk a little bit about Browder versus Gale. This was the first civil rights lawsuit that you filed in federal court.
That's correct.
And Judge Johnson was your judge.
Well, it was a three-judge district court, so he was one of the three judges. He was one. Judge Reeves from the Court of Appeals was one. And let me see, I think it was Judge Grooms. No, it wasn't Grooms. I think it may have been Grooms, but anyway, it was Judge Lynn was the other one. So that was a three-judge court.
Was this then Judge Johnson's first civil rights case, as far as you know?
As far as I know, this is the first civil rights case that Judge Johnson had.
And this case was the full integration of the bus system here in Montgomery.
That's right, because, see, he became judge in October. And the case was filed in February. I believe this was the first civil rights case that he was involved in, yes.
And this case went all the way to the Supreme Court.
Yes, it did. We had a three-judge court, and it was appealed to the Supreme Court. We filed a motion to affirm, and the court granted our motion to affirm.
Was there any pressure on you to dismiss that case or that lawsuit?
There was a great deal of pressure from a lot of different aspects of it. Shortly after I filed the lawsuit, one of the plaintiffs in it, Mrs. Reeves, who lived on South Hope Street, and I later found out she had been employed by some of the policemen in the city of Montgomery. When things got a little rough and the newspapers started calling her, she denied that she had given her permission for me to file the suit. So that made the headlines. And sometime later, in March of that same year, I was indicted for allegedly representing her without her consent. I received several phone calls from some high city, county, and even some federal people who were concerned about the case of Browder versus Gale. They thought that we had a nice community and felt that this might really upset things and wanted to know if there wasn't some way that this case could be dismissed. Of course, I told them I'd be glad to discuss it with my clients, and I did. And I reported back to them that the clients really felt that the movement was going on, the people were walking, and they had made a commitment that they were going to continue to walk until when they returned to the buses, they'd do it on an integrated basis. And if they were now ready to integrate the buses, they'd be able to do it because they weren't willing to do that, so the case continued. Then they wanted to know if we would agree just to put it off. And, of course, we didn't do that. We just kept pressing right along.
Well, now, were you prosecuted because of bringing this lawsuit because of what you just told us about the plaintiff not agreeing that you had her authority?
Yes, I was. I was indicted by the same grand jury that indicted about almost 80-some-odd other persons involved in the bus boycott in that march, and they were indicted for allegedly engaging in an illegal boycott of the buses. They didn't indict me for that, but they indicted me for allegedly representing this person who I said was a client, and they said was not a client. And I was arraigned in the circuit court. But I was never tried.
During that time, did you get any special advice from Judge Johnson regarding that Browder case?
Well, I wouldn't say there was any special advice from him, but what happened was I did receive a call from him one day, and he wanted to discuss Browder versus Gale, which was then pending. And when we finished discussing that, he then said he'd noticed in the newspaper about this case that was against me and wanted to know how things were going. And I said, well, I guess about as well as to be expected. And he says, well, you know, if any offense was committed, it was committed on the second floor of this federal building. And that was the end of our conversation. That could be interpreted any number of ways. Our lawyers had already concluded and had papers that were filed challenging the indictment, among other things, saying that if any offense were committed, the actual commission of the offense would have been when the papers were filed in this federal building, and that the United States government had exclusive jurisdiction over. Eventually, the indictment was dismissed. The state solicitor said he was going to refer the matter to the U.S. attorney, and I never heard anything else from it.
Who were some of the unsung heroes of that bus boycott?
Well, of course, you have many of them. I've already talked about Claudette Carvin was one. And incidentally, I received a phone call today from a newspaper person who's writing about Rosa Parks, and we talked about Claudette. Mary Louise Smith is another young lady who was arrested under very similar circumstances before Ms. Parks. She was arrested during the summer. And we didn't even know about Ms. Smith until the bus boycott started. She simply, they went and fined her $5 in costs, and she paid the $9 and just didn't say anything to anybody about it. But the real people who made it a success are the 40,000 African Americans who walked the streets of Montgomery in the rain and the sunshine under very adverse circumstances and stayed off of the buses rather than to ride them on a segregated basis. And the whole civil rights movement, as it evolved from Montgomery to throughout the southern states and even the northern states, you'll find that there are a lot of persons involved in the movement who you never read about them in the papers, you never see the faces, but for those persons, the ones that we read about and the ones we do see, what they did would never have been possible.
Now, you talked about a lot of people walking, and you alluded to a little earlier about carpools. Were there any cases involving persons who helped to transport the walkers?
Because we had all kinds of cases in state court, not in federal court, that involved from speeding tickets to too many people riding in, to operating taxis without a license, to running stop signs. There were a multiplicity of those cases. And there was even a case later on that they filed in state court to enjoin the operation of the buses. I alluded to the criminal cases that were in state courts. But the main case in federal court to integrate the buses was the case of Browder versus Gale that we've already talked about.
Did you move to Tuskegee in Macon County during this period, or where were you living then?
No, I was living in Montgomery at that time. I lived in Montgomery from the time, well, really from birth until going away only time I was in school, until 1964. Because we're quite a little distant from 64. We're still back in 55 and 56.
In the case of Lewis versus the Greyhound bus, and I'm specifically calling your attention to the Freedom Riders, was that, what was the importance of the Freedom Riders case?
Well, what you had in 19, because the bus boycott ended in the latter part of 1956, there were another series of events that happened before the Freedom Rider case, but I'll go on to the Freedom Rider case because you have Gumillion v. Lightfoot that occurred in 1956 and 57.
Let us step back then, and let's, before we talk about the Freedom Rider case, I want to go back to, you had a period there where you were doing quite a bit of work in Selma, Alabama, in 55, with and I'm calling your attention to the city of Selma versus Wesley Jones, Jr.
Yeah, actually, Wesley Jones was an airman stationed at Craig Air Force Base and was on his way home one evening. He lived in the city, and there was a white couple in front of him, and both of them had stopped for the traffic light. The light changed, and the car in front of Wesley Jones did not move off immediately. He tooted his horn, and apparently it disturbed the people in the car ahead of him, and it was a white couple. There were some words expressed between the white couple and Wesley Jones, and then both of them went on about their business. A couple of hours later, the city police come to Wesley Jones' house and arrest him. And he is arrested and charged with disorderly conduct. He's supposed to have said something to the white lady who was in the car. And this case, but for the fact that you had a white and a black involved, would not have been too important, but I'll give you a little something about what happened in the trial of the case, and it sets the tone to show the racial climate in Selma as early as 1955 and how things later developed into the Selma to Montgomery March, and Selma developing into a real hotbed and hot spot in the civil rights movement. But I was called by the president of the NAACP in Selma on the Wesley Jones case, because Wesley Jones had gone to them and thought that this was really a racial situation, so they got me to come over and represent him, and I did. What I would normally do when I would go someplace, I tried not to travel alone unless I had to. And I went along with a fellow named Frank Massey, who was a disabled veteran, lived here. Elbert Hill, young man who later became my brother-in-law. And they were in court, so we went ahead, we tried the case. During the course of the case, I was referring to my client as Mr. Jones. And the judge said to me, "You don't call him that in this court." And I really didn't quite understand what he meant. So I said, "I beg your pardon." He said, "You don't call him that in this court." Then it dawned on me that the judge was objecting to me referring to my client as Mr. Jones. And I told him, I said, "Well, he is a sergeant in the United States Air Force. May I refer to him as Sergeant Jones?" "Oh, yes, that's fine." And if you will look at these early civil rights cases, particularly those in state court, and I'm not sure about federal, but particularly in state courts, you will see when they refer to the white lawyers, they will refer to them as Mr. So-and-so. And when they refer to the black lawyers, they will refer to them as Lawyer So-and-so. When that was over, of course, they found my man guilty, and I was fixing to go to find somebody to sign his bond, and I only knew one black man over in Selma who white people would accept a bond from, and that was Mr. Moss, so I had to go and try to find him. But when I looked for Frank, and I didn't see Frank Massey. So it was a great big white police officer. When I looked up, it looked like he was about 6 feet. He wasn't quite that tall, but he's a large fellow. And he looked down on me and said, "If you're looking for that so-and-so who brought you over here."
He used the N-word.
Yeah, he used the N-word, and he's locked up. Well, I understood quite clearly what he said, but I didn't know what to say, so I said, "I beg your pardon," and he repeated it the same way. So I said, "Well, may I," then I asked him, "Well, why is he in jail?" He said he was sitting in the courtroom drinking liquor. Well, I knew Frank wouldn't do that. Number one, he didn't have any. Number two, you know better than to do that anyway. So I went back and talked to Frank, and they let me go back and talk with him. He said, "Well," I said, "what happened is I was sitting there where you saw, and after a while, a fella came in and sat by me, because the courtroom was segregated, whites on one side, blacks on the other. And the guy was dressed in a white outfit, a black fella. He came, sat for a couple of minutes, and he got up and left. And then a few minutes later, a police officer came and touched Frank on the shoulder, because the police officer, all on them were white. Say, "Come on, go with me and bring that bottle under your seat with you. And sure enough, that was a bottle of liquor under his seat. We later found out that the man who had come was a trustee that they had sent in with the whisker and had left the bottle there. When I got back from trying to get a bond for my client, they had released Frank Massey, but only after they lectured to him. They said, now you tell that so-and-so lawyer that he think he's smart, and they have a mess going on in Montgomery, and tell him when he go across that bridge, don't ever come back to Selma, because we're not going to have any mess over here." I didn't come back to Selma for a long time, but I think that shows the pattern, and ultimately we were able to get that case dismissed, that Selma was a place where racial tension was high, and there were people even that early working, trying to do something about race conditions.
And that case, Wesley Jones, was a little prior to Browder, because that was in 55 and Browder was in 56.
Yeah, I tried the Wesley Jones case in the Recorder's Court of the City of Selma right before Christmas or right after Christmas. It may have been on about the 27th of December. And that was right after Ms. Parks had been arrested and right in the middle of the bus boycott.
And was the next time you went to Selma with the case of a State of Alabama versus Lewis Anderson back in 61?
Yeah, that was the next major case, civil rights case. Actually, Reverend Anderson, L.L. Anderson, was a pastor of the Tabernacle Baptist Church and was very instrumental in the whole movement. And what happened was, unfortunately, he was driving from his house to his church and struck a black young man, and the man died. It was an automobile accident, but they charged him with murder. And then was willing to work something out with him if he would leave town. He never did leave town. We finally, that case went up to the Supreme Court of the United States, excuse me, some three or four times, basically on the question of systematically excluding blacks from juries over there. So I think all of that shows that things were really being set to for conditions in Selma.
Mr. Gray, we know that Senator Engelhardt had a bill passed in the legislature, Bill 140, in 1957, that excluded blacks in Macon County. Could you tell us how this triggered the landmark case of Gomillion versus Lightfoot?
Yes, let me give you a little background. Macon County, where I now live and practice, basically, is a county that has always been predominantly African American, as much as 80%. It is the home of Tuskegee University, formerly Tuskegee Institute. It is also the home of what at one time was the fifth largest African-American Veterans Administration hospital in the nation. You have had, because of those two institutions, Tuskegee Institute and the VA hospital, a large number of African-Americans who were highly educated, many of them having the terminal degrees. And yet, we had very few African-Americans who were registered to vote. So in Macon County, there had been a concerted effort on the part of the local group known as the Tuskegee Civic Association, of which Dr. Gomillion was the president, of trying to get people registered. And this goes back to the late 30s and early 40s. And they even filed a lawsuit, a federal lawsuit, as early as 1945 for the purpose of getting the right to vote. And later on, the Justice Department ended up in the late mid-50s filing a suit also against Macon County trying to get the right to vote. We finally were able in 1956 to have in the city limits approximately 400 registered voters. There was an election, a city election was coming up. And this city election, if it had gone as originally scheduled, it would have meant, with 400 voters being African Americans, while it was not enough to elect an African American to any of the municipal offices, it would have been sufficient enough to be the balance of power. So if they voted together, anyone they supported would have been elected. The Senator Engelhardt and others did not want that to happen. So he passed a very simple bill. Act number 140 simply changed the city limits of Tuskegee. The city used to be a square so many miles from the courthouse in each direction. They changed it so that if you counted the number of sides, it would have about 28 sides. The effect of the bill was that it excluded all of the black registered voters except five. And the only reason those five were not excluded because they could not have excluded them without excluding some whites. And that same bill changing the city limits did not exclude or remove any white person from the city limits. Now, this is a very difficult case because what they're saying is that we're not discriminating against anybody because of their race. We're not denying anybody the right to vote because of their race. They are able to vote in county elections. They're able to vote in federal elections. They're able to vote in state elections. They can't vote in city election, not because their race doesn't have a thing to do with it. It's just that they don't live in the city. And And since they don't live in the city, if white folks didn't live in the city, they couldn't vote. Well, that was a case, Colgrove versus Green, which Justice Frankfurter had written an opinion some time ago, involving the gerrymandering of a congressional seat, probably up in Pennsylvania, one of the northern states. And in that opinion, he had said that was a question where they were gerrymandering this district so that they could have a safe district for one of the parties to run from. And the court ended up saying that there was no federal jurisdiction because this was a political question and that the court should stay out of the political thicket. So I had a real difficult time of finding anybody who thought I had a cause of action. Excuse me. I talked to Robert Carter, who I had talked to before on Browder versus Gale, and who had helped me on that. He was general counsel for the NAACP. And so he wanted to know, he said, well, Fred, how are you going to approach it? I said, well, let's do the same thing we did in Browder versus Gale, a suit for declaratory judgment and for injunctive relief with name as plaintiffs would be some of the people who've been excluded from the city, and file the suit against the persons who have the responsibility of enforcing it, and that'd be the city officials. And he told me that they were having a meeting out in Dallas, and that we would have periodic meetings in those days of lawyers who worked with the NAACP. And he asked me to draft a complaint, bring it out there with him, and he would see what he could do. True enough, I did that. We went out there. He still didn't think I had much of a chance, but he did agree to work with me on the case, and we filed it. I had sat down and tried to determine the best way to illustrate and to win this case, and I came up with an idea that the best way to do it is to have a map that has both the old and the new city limits superimposed on it. And hopefully by showing this to the court, they would see really what has happened. So I spoke to my TCA people, particularly Mr. Mitchell, told him what I needed, went ahead, and true enough, in about a couple of months, I had the prettiest map you want to see.
Was that William Mitchell?
William P. Mitchell, who was the key person, as he was the secretary to the Tuskegee Civic Association and litigant in many of our cases. So we filed a complaint. Sure enough, they filed motions to dismiss, saying that it was a political question. And Judge Frank M. Johnson dismissed my complaint, and I was disappointed. I had my map. I was all ready to demonstrate it and show it, and behold, it was not there. Well, we appealed to the Fifth Circuit. Finally got a ruling from the Fifth Circuit, and I lost in the Fifth Circuit, but there was a dissenting opinion, and the judge in that dissenting opinion gave me what I thought was a roadmap. I went home that day, all smiles, and Bernice said, Gray, I don't understand you, and that's what she called me. She said, you go and lose a case, and you're around here happy. I said, well, I figure if I picked up one out of three in the Fifth Circuit, I can get 5 out of 9 in the U.S. Supreme Court. And we did take it to the Supreme Court. I was still determined to use my map. So when I went up to argue the case before the Supreme Court, in addition to carrying my briefcase, I carried this big map all wrapped up. I went in and talked to the clerk. They brought the marshal in, and I told him, I said, now when I get ready to argue, I'd like for you to put this map up right behind me. They said, it's fine. I get up and start arguing my case, and before I can get started, Mr. Justice Frankfurter, I'm already afraid of him, wants to know, counsel, what is this behind you? I told him, Mr. Justice Frankfurter, this is a map of the city of Tuskegee. the old city limits and the new city limits imposed in it. He says, the city of Tuskegee, he said, fine. He said, where is Tuskegee Institute? I pointed out Tuskegee Institute. He said, where is Tuskegee Institute? He said, it's in the city limits, isn't it? I said, no, sir, Mr. Justice. Tuskegee Institute's not in the city limits. He looked up. He said, Tuskegee Institute not in the city limits of the city of Tuskegee? I said, no, sir. I think the map got the justice's vote. And we not only got five, we got a unanimous court. And the opinion in Gomillion versus Lightfoot has been quoted many, many times, and even now is being used for reverse discrimination. But I think it has set the precedent for any number of other cases that have come along, the whole business of single-member districts, the business of not being able to dilute the black vote, and many of the other principles in the field of voting, registration, and the election of officers can be traced back to, and they can give as the precedent for it, Gomillion v. Lightfoot. I think of all the cases that I've handled in terms of legal precedents, that case probably is the greatest one. I just don't want to see it misapplied now and used to end up turning the clock back. And that's one of the problems that we lawyers must face now.
Now, that boycott that started because of the gerrymandering, was that the basis of John Patterson versus TCA?
Well, you know, what happened to all of these movements, you know, there's so many different dynamics that's going on. Because when you went back to the bus boycott, you had the bus boycott was one thing. You had these people who was off. You had all these indictments going on. You had Mrs. Park's arrest. You had Browder versus Gale. Now, at the same time, what the people in Tuskegee decided, they would first go to the local merchants and said, look, we all live here together. These people are registered to vote. Go and have this act repealed and let our people vote in municipal election. They said, well, our hands are tied. We didn't do that. The legislature did it. I said, well, fine. Then what we'll do is we simply won't trade with you until you decide to let us back in the city. If you don't want us in the city to vote, then you don't want us in the city to buy your merchandise. They started a selective campaign, and they had a meeting in Tuskegee, just as they had in Montgomery, every week at a different church. And they would have these inspirational speakers who would come down, and Dr. King came at a certain point. I spoke to him, and they had local speakers and speakers from across the country. And they continued to have that selective campaign until Gomillion v. Lightfoot was ultimately reversed. And of course, somewhat like the city of Montgomery, as far as the bus company never recuperated from the bus boycott. And downtown merchants in Tuskegee has never recuperated. But at the same time, while that was going on, then John Patterson was attorney general. He had received the Democratic nomination for attorney general after his father had run and was killed before he could take office. And so John Patterson had a little earlier, I think on the 1st of June, 1956, had filed a suit in the Circuit Court of Montgomery County to enjoin the NAACP from doing business. And then a while later, he comes over and filed a suit in the Circuit Court of Macon County to make the black merchants trade with the white merchants. And so we had a big case on that, but.
Now, let us step back a minute. You mentioned that Mr. Patterson had brought, sued the NAACP, and this case, that was the case that went to the Supreme Court of Alabama, and it involved what major legal point?
Okay, here's what happened. I think it was June 1st, 1956. John Patterson, as Attorney General, filed a suit against the NAACP and asked that they be enjoined from doing business in Alabama because they had not qualified to do business as a foreign corporation. And of course, they had not. But so had a lot of non-profit corporations. Very few of them had really qualified to do business. But they didn't mind qualifying to do business, but then they went ahead, and in the discovery, he wanted to have a list of the names and addresses on the membership of the persons on the NAACP. And they recognized the fact that if that were to happen, all of the members would be probably fired and would be subject to economic reprisals, and they would not give it up. George Walter B. Jones entered an order fining them $100,000 and then enjoining them from qualifying to do business until they purge themselves. And in order to purge themselves, they must give up the membership list. So in that case, we raised several issues. One was the fact that an organization had the right to assert the right of its members in a situation like this because these individual people were not sued in it, but the organization was. And secondly, not only did they have that right, but we also had the question of being able to protect people against reprisals. And if it meant that they're going to be subject to reprisal, then they should not have to do that, and they should be permitted to qualify to do business. The case ultimately went up to the United States Supreme Court, I think, on four separate occasions over about a nine-month period, twice through the state court system, and I think twice through this court, because Judge Johnson dismissed the case either once or twice by when we filed it over here. But ultimately, the Supreme Court ruled in our favor, and we were able, and the NAACP was able, to do business again in the state, and has been doing business ever since.
Now, that was a few years before the Patterson suing TCA in regards to their boycott with Gomillion.
Well,
is that correct?
It overlaps. Well, see, the NAACP case spans a term of over 8 years, from 1956, when it initially happened, and when I think we were finally able to qualify to do business, was probably in 1964 or so. And the TCA injunction suit was probably in about 57, something like that.
Now, is this a good time to go back and talk about the Freedom Riders?
All right. Of course, Freedom Riders started really about 1960. What you had was several student groups. That was CORE, Congress of Equality. Then you had SNCC, who was also another student group. And what these people decided to do was, the Interstate Commerce Commission had already had a rule that in interstate travel you cannot discriminate. So if you can't discriminate in interstate travel, it means that if they were riding a bus crossing state lines, and they would be able to use the cafeteria in these places and not be discriminated against. So the idea was to test these bus companies throughout the South and see what happened. So you had a group of students and others who started in D.C., and they were going to come through Virginia and the Carolinas and Georgia and Alabama and Mississippi and going down to New Orleans and testing whether they could use lunch counters. And on that trip, they also came to Montgomery and came to the bus station, which is the next adjoining property to this building. And of course, once they got there, there was a big mob that was waiting on them, and they were really just beaten. And we ended up filing a suit. I think the one that you referred to, is that the
John Lewis.
John Lewis versus the Greyhound Bus Company. And it was for the purpose of enforcing, to have them to be sure they enforce the ICC regulations about non-discrimination in interstate travel.
Is this John Lewis, the same Congressman Lewis?
That's the same John Lewis who sometime, he was one of the organizers of SNCC. And he's the same John Lewis who later, with SNCC, went to Selma and started the voter registration drive over there, which resulted in the massacre, I like to think of it, not with death, but in terms of how they were treated on Bloody Sunday, where they were all beaten back. And after they were beaten back on that day, they retained me for the purpose of obtaining a court order to make them, make the state of Alabama and George Wallace, who had told them that there would be no march from Selma to Montgomery to protect them. And we were able to do that. We came to this court and we had an expedited hearing with Judge Johnson, and then the other side was concerned about appeal, and Judge Johnson set up a special, had a panel of appellate court judges in New Orleans, and when we were had a hearing with him that morning, he told us that there was a special appellate court set up to hear the appeal in the case at 6 o'clock that evening. And one of the lawyers on the other side made a statement to the judge, wanted to know whether he had made reservations for him. He says, no, I haven't made reservations for you, but I know they have space. What finally happened on that case, and what Judge Johnson did early on in these cases, he was very concerned that any order he entered would be enforced. And I'm sure that I didn't have the privilege of being one of his law clerks because I was out at that time, but I'm sure some of the persons who served as his law clerk knows more about this than I do. But early on, because these orders were so important, even in Browder versus Gale, the judge recognized that it was very, very important that if he entered an order, he wanted to be sure it was going to be enforced. So he came up with the idea of designating the government as amicus. And he did that in a number of cases. He did it in, I know, in all the school desegregation cases that we did. And he did it in the Selma to Montgomery March case. And when we were ready to leave his office to go down, and the lawyer who was representing the Justice Department in that case was John Doerr, who later became rather famous all over the South for handling these civil rights cases. The state lawyers did not go down to New Orleans on the regular commercial flight. They had a state plane to go down. I was with John Doerr, and John told me that government, because he wanted to go down and get back, was chartering a plane to go down to New Orleans. And since I was representing the plaintiff, I could go along with him. So the state goes down in the state plane, and we get on this little chartered plane to go down to New Orleans. We have our hearing, they affirm Judge Johnson, then we're all ready to go back. In the meanwhile, a cold front comes in. And what happens with the cold front is, and there was no de-icing on the little plane that we had. They didn't worry about me getting back to Montgomery, but John Doerr needed to get back to Montgomery because they had a lot of people out at Maxwell making preparations for the Selma to Montgomery march. And what finally happened was that John Doerr called to Montgomery and ended up getting one of the Telstar executive planes that they had for people coming into Montgomery from Washington and sent that plane down to pick us up and bring us back, and we ended up being able to move right along. Yes, New York Times versus Sullivan. It started out really as Sullivan versus New York Times. It was a suit filed in the Circuit Court of Montgomery County by the then Sullivan was the police commissioner in the city of Montgomery. The New York Times had run an ad. And in that ad, it had something. It was for the purpose of raising funds for the defense of Dr. Martin Luther King and freedom in the South. What had happened was, in 1960, Dr. King was indicted by a Montgomery County grand jury in connection with state income tax evasion for, I believe it was the year of 55 and 56, so either 55 and 56 or 56 and 57. It was 2 years involved. And Dr. King at this time has left Montgomery. The Montgomery bus boycott's been over for years. He has now formed the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. He is its chair. They are in Atlanta. They have, he is now speaking out against the war, the Vietnam War. And they indict him in effect for perjury, saying in effect that while he has been talking about nonviolence and leading these people all over the country and traveling around the world, he is nothing more than just someone who has defrauded the government, the state of Alabama, and who did not pay his state income taxes. Well, there had been some question about his state taxes before, and he thought the matter was resolved because the agent who was investigating him didn't find anything wrong with his tax return, and he told him that. But they went ahead and indicted him anyway, and then, of course, everybody knew that I'd been representing Dr. King since he had become to prominence since the bus boycott. No one said anything to us about the indictments, and instead of giving him an opportunity, they sent the indictments to Georgia with the idea of having him just arrested and summarily brought back here, because they were able to work it out with the Georgia officials. And it was a very important case. In my opinion, Dr. King's, this case was probably the most important case in his whole career. Because if they could prove that he was nothing more than a perjured individual and who wouldn't pay his taxes, then it would do away with his credibility. Plus, he's now talking about the Vietnam War, which was a very sensitive issue. We concluded that we needed to, and all of his other people, plus he's now in Atlanta. And while I did not do any work for him over in Atlanta, they decided they needed to develop the best team of lawyers that we could have in order to defend him on this criminal charge in Montgomery. So they got Judge Delaney, who was a retired black judge in New York, who was an excellent judge and an excellent legal scholar and an excellent writer. And they had Bob Ming, who was a black tax lawyer out of Chicago. And then I was the local lawyer. And they were able to get a CPA out of Georgia who was black, but who had credentials, including members of some accountant societies in Great Britain and the Netherlands. And we put together quite a team because this was very important to Dr. King and was important to us as his lawyers. We filed all kinds of motions, of course, before we even got to the question of systematically excluding blacks from the juries, and that was occurring then. That was something else. And it was a theory that we put out, and it still hasn't been resolved. It became moot later on. But this is the way this theory went. The circuit judges in Montgomery County are all elected. African Americans were excluded from being registered voters. So all of the circuit judges who were elected, where blacks had been excluded from voting, were illegally elected, and therefore they should not be, and they should recuse themselves, and they're disqualified from deciding any case involving any black person. Sounds like another lawyer's theory that I know about. But it was, and we had some law to back it up. Not the precise issue, but it was a lawyer-like argument, and we had that, because you know it was overruled. And all of the other motions were overruled. Then we finally got down to the actual business of trying the case. And it was a very interesting case. One of the most important witnesses in that case was the career white employee of the state of Alabama, who, when he got on the stand, told the truth about what he found on Dr. King's returns. And he admitted that years before, when this issue came up, and when he went over it, he found nothing wrong with the tax returns. And he stuck with that. Then we had this black accountant who really had gone through all of his records and all of his assets and everything to show that he did not have any money. And the money that they were claiming that he had gotten, he simply didn't get it. And it was just all something that somebody had made up. The results was, while we had the St. John Dixon versus Alabama State Board, which we haven't talked about yet, but this is all coming up at the same time, and those were the Lynch County demonstrations in the courthouse at Montgomery. We had those cases coming. And now Dr. King's case is being tried before an all-white male jury in Montgomery County. And guess what happened? He was exonerated, found not guilty. Now, why the press and why the white community don't use that case any more than they do, it passes my imagination, because this shows at least white men in Montgomery, in the middle of all these other things, on a tax case which meant so much to Dr. King, and regardless of how they may have felt personally about what he was doing on these race issues, they felt that on the tax question, he had not lied. So it's very important.
How did that get then with New York Times and the supporters?
Let me get back to that. They were raising money to defend Dr. King in that case. And they had a committee up in New York, and the person who, A. Philip Randolph, was a part of it, Bide Rustin, who was an activist, was probably doing all the administrative detail. They concluded that one way to get support was to have an ad in the New York Times. And by having the ad in the New York Times asking people to make contributions, that's the way they would raise the money.
To defend Dr. King.
To defend Dr. King and freedom in the South. Our language to that effect is what the ad said. But then they also, and of course, nobody local knew anything about the ad was going to be in the paper. But they added on it an endorsement by several local black preachers, including Ralph Abernathy, Fred Shuttlesworth, Reverend Lowry, and Dr. Sett. So, it said somewhere in the ad something about how the officials, how the police officials of the city of Montgomery had treated them in connection with the bus boycott. So, Commissioner Sullivan concluded that that reference was to him, even though he was not named. So he said that libeled him. And he sent out letters, his lawyer did, in preparations for the case, to the four black preachers. And of course, they wanted them so that they would be able to keep the court in state court and wouldn't be able to remove it to federal court. They sent letters of retraction telling them to, they had, was it 5 days or 10 days to retract this, or they were going to file suit. Of course, they didn't respond to it. And I remember when we were trying the case, I handled the case on the trial, I didn't handle the appeal. But one of my arguments to the jury on that case was when they were talking about the matter of tracking or retracting the statement. And I say you can't retract what you didn't track, because these men never knew anything at all about the ad. They never authorized it or anything. Of course, the result of it was that the jury, and this was another all-male white jury. This was some 6 months later in the fall of 60. Now, we may have been too ambitious and may have thought that we were going to be as fortunate in that case as we were with Dr. King, other case, but we lost that one. And that ultimately went to the Supreme Court. And as you know, the Supreme Court then ruled. It changed the law of libel so that now you're going to have to show you can criticize a public official, and unless you're able to show malice, and you can't just imply it, and that changed the whole law of libel. So I think one of the things this points up to is that in the civil rights era, and this is just one phase of it, there was so much law that has been made in other areas that had nothing at all to do with civil rights per se, but had its genesis in the civil rights movement. Let me give you another example of that and then I move on. But it does deal with some cases that this court deals with every day. You take the 14th Amendment to the United States Constitution. We usually say that there are three amendments that were primarily for black folks. 13th Amendment freed us. 14th Amendment gave us the right to be citizens, and the 15th Amendment gave us the right to vote. Now, the 14th Amendment and the Due Process Clause thereof was primarily designed for black folks. But now, everybody use the due process and equal protection provision of the 14th Amendment. It applies everywhere. So you see, the laws that we made in the civil rights field have been applicable across the board to everybody, and while we were doing what we were doing, and it helped to free black folks, it has really helped everybody, and it's helped to make justice work. But I had met Dr. King shortly after he came to Montgomery. I was not a member of his church and did not know him in real intimate details. I probably was educated on Dr. King more the night of Mrs. Park's arrest than at any other time. Because even though I'd had lunch with Ms. Parks the day of her arrest and had no idea she was going to do what she did, I was out of town when she was actually arrested. And when I got back and had calls from her, I went to her house and talked with her, and she wanted me to represent her. Then I left her house and went to E.D. Nixon's house, and we talked. Then I left there and went to Joanne Robinson. And that's another one of those unsung heroes that you talked about earlier. And I spent Joanne and I talked for the next 4 or 5 hours because she had had a problem with buses, as I'd indicated to you back in 48. And she was with us when we went down on Claudette Carvin's case. And we concluded that we don't want to happen this time, coming up to the bus boycott in Ms. Park's case, as to what happened before. So we decided on our own, and both of us were in positions where we could not come out in the public and tell what all we did or what our views were. She worked for Alabama State, and if they had known, like they later found out, what she had done, they would have fired her, and she still later lost it. And if they had known all of the details in my involvement, they probably would have disbarred me like they tried to do on any number of occasions. But we concluded, among other things, in that discussion, and get to your answer. And that is, when we get through all of these things, and if the boycott's going to be successful, we need to have a leader. And the question is, who should that leader be? Now, we knew we needed every black person in the city to be with us. We knew that E.D. Nixon had a group of people who were following him. Rufus Lewis had a group of people following him. We were afraid that if we selected either one of those as the spokesman, we'd lose somebody. So the idea is find somebody else to serve as spokesman and give them key roles to play. And so she said, well, Fred, I'll tell you who will make a good spokesman. My pastor, Dr. Martin Luther King. She says that he's a good speaker. He's an excellent preacher. He hasn't been here long. He hasn't been involved in any of the civil rights activities. He's just been concerned about Dexter and taking care of the members there. But he has tremendous speaking ability, and he would be the ideal person. So I said, well, Joanne, you know him much better than I do. If you think he's the one, then that's the person that we ought to try to see that he gets it. And then we, between ourselves, assigned each other certain responsibilities, and then we were going to touch people who would touch people who would touch people. And when it came down at the official meeting, Martin Luther King was selected as the chairman at a meeting when he was not even there. Abernathy was the vice chair. Rufus Lewis was the chairman of the transportation because his wife, at that time, owned a half interest in Ross Clayton Funeral Home, and they had cars at their disposal that they could get a transportation system. And Rufus Lewis, E.D. Nixon had his fingers on Mr. A. Philip Randolph and the labor unions where they could get money, and I was selected as the lawyer. From that day forward, when he was selected on that Monday afternoon, from that day, until Dr. King left Montgomery, I dealt with him on a day-to-day basis because there was every day some problems and something that we had to talk about in order to keep the bus boycott going. But when you would get him in situations where we didn't have to do business, he would points where I'd tell him the law is this. He said, well, Fred, you know, we know what the law says, but there's a higher law. And there's our conscience that we have to deal with. And so now, when we get in jail, don't worry about getting us out. When we get ready for you to get us out, you can get us out. But there's a higher law, and it's our conscience, and we will not put up with evil. And that's the type of person he was, a very easygoing person.
Would you discuss with us your venture into student rights? Because that was a venture into student rights, the St. John Dixon versus Alabama State Board of Education.
Yes, another very precedent-setting case. What happened is that the students up at, I think it was South Carolina State or North Carolina State, up in the Carolinas, one of them, all these activities were going on in the early 60s, and they wanted to be a part of it. They had these SNCC kids that were, some of them that were coming, riding buses going throughout the South, but there were other college students, African Americans, who couldn't leave their studies and who wanted to be a part of the movement. So they started picketing the lunch counters. Because, see, these lunch counters were not covered under the ICC regulation. So they started by attending, going to one of the lunch counters in South Carolina. The students did. They were arrested. You had the beginning of student protests across the nation. The students at Alabama State decided they wanted to do the same thing. So they decided, instead of going to the stores, the dime stores downtown and sitting at the lunch counter, that was a lunch counter, wasn't much of a lunch counter, but that was a lunch counter in the Montgomery County Courthouse. So they decided to go there. And Joe L. Reed was one of those persons who were involved, who was leading the movement at the time. So they went down, and the sheriff would not arrest them. He simply closed the lunch counter. And after they closed the lunch counter, because you can't get in the service with the lunch counter closed, they went on back out to the campus. John Patterson is no longer Attorney General. He's now the governor. So he gets on the phone and talks to Dr. Trenum, who's president of Alabama State. And he tells Dr. Trenum, he wants them to find out who those students were who were sitting in at the courthouse and want them out. Dr. Trenum found out who was out there, and the ones who were residents of the state who participated were suspended, and that included Dr. Reed. The ones who were non-residents of the state were expelled, and that included John Dixon and the others who became plaintiffs in this lawsuit. So I filed a suit on behalf of St. John Dixon and these other students who were expelled from Alabama State. And the suit, of course, was against the college and against the state. And it was a very interesting case. This is another one of the cases that I lost before Judge Johnson in this courtroom. He dismissed it, saying two things. And one, students, even at a state-supported institution, does not have a right to an education, that an education is a privilege and not a right. And two, if they don't have a right, you can summarily suspel, you can expel them, or you can discipline them, and they're not entitled to any kind of hearing. We'll appeal the case because we felt two things. One, that at state-supported institutions, as a matter of right, you have a right to an education. It's not a privilege, it's a right. And you can't take that right away, if it is a right, without affording due process. And that due process includes charges and an opportunity to have a hearing. And believe it or not, the Supreme Court ended up ruling with us on that issue. So you then had those two basic principles was announced in that case, that an education at a state-supported institution is a right, and along with that right means that they cannot summarily discharge you without affording you both procedural and substantive due process. And all the hearings and all the things, that doctrine has been expanded to include all the problems we're having now. I found out some years later, again, showing how these things develop. There's an organization known as NACOA, National Association of College and University Attorneys. These are lawyers that represent colleges and universities all over, and it's quite an organization now. But when St. John Dixon was decided, there were a few of the lawyers who represented the universities who met for the purpose of deciding what in the world are we going to do with St. John Dixon, because this is all new. And out of that came the organization ANACOA. About 4 or 5 years ago, I was going in a ward. I later, when I was representing Alabama State and Tuskegee, it's a member organization where the institutions are members and their lawyers go to represent them. I ended up being on their board, and then some years later, they created a new award, and I was the first person to receive it, and I received it because I was the person who was responsible for being instrumental in filing Dixon versus Alabama State, which gave birth to NACOA.
What about your theory about being a shotgun lawyer, shall I say?
Well, my approach has always been I don't like to file any lawsuit where I don't have but one theory or one cause of action. Sometimes we may have to do it. But my idea, as long as you can come forth with a reasonable legal argument and have some logic, in fact or in law, hopefully in both, but never in neither, that it's just much better, because I've seen too many occasions when I thought, and this is true of courts from the bench and jurors, when I thought that this point was really the strong point, only to find out that there were jurors or there was a court who thought that point wasn't worth anything. But here's another one over here. So as long if I can put them all out there, it really doesn't make any difference with me which way or which one the court or the jury selects, as long as they select one. So I do call myself a shotgun lawyer, meaning the one that has a lot of
theories. Now, we were talking about the St. John Dixon and your venture then into education, and that was all about the same time that you started in Macon County with the major education lawsuit, Lee versus Macon County Board of Education in 1963.
Let me give you a little background on it, because, see, during the old days, we didn't have too many lawyers who were handling these kind of cases, and the NAACP and the NAACP Legal Defense Fund tried to, they had lawyers who cooperated with them, and we would usually meet and try to plan strategy so that we could build on our gains. And in doing all of that, we would also try to know those forums that we thought would be most favorable toward these hard decisions that we were trying to make. And it doesn't make sense to go and file a suit in an area where you know the district judge is going to dismiss you before you get started, if you can go someplace else and get a more favorable decision and probably take that one up and get a good precedent on an appellate level that you can use. So in 1963, we are now almost 10 years after Brown versus the Board of Education, and basically there are very few schools in the South integrated, and very few in Alabama, and none in the Middle District. So they were concerned, the NAACP was, the local branch as well as the national organization, of having some school cases. And they asked me if I would end up filing some for them. I told them I'd be glad to. So about the same time, we filed four or five cases. We filed Harris versus the Crenshaw County Board of Education. We filed Harris versus the Bullock County Board of Education. We filed Franklin versus the Barber County Board of Education. We filed Lee versus the Macon County Board of Education. And we filed Carr versus the Montgomery County Board of Education. Those five cases. And these were all cases in counties where I had some cases and had some clients and had some people who were very interested in what we were all trying to do. And all of these cases were just similar. So it wasn't difficult. The complaints, basically you do one, it's the same. And the white community in most, in all of them, didn't want integration. You may have had a few who would suffer it to be, but they didn't want it. But most of them were saying it's the law of the land, we are law-abiding citizens, so we will abide by it and go ahead and do the best. So there's no problems really with down in Crenshaw County, no problems in Bullock, no problems in Barber, no real problems in Montgomery, which we may talk about later on, but we had the pupil placement law, which was a pain in the neck, but it was out there, and until we got it over, we'd have to deal with it, and that was Montgomery. So that fall, in all four of the five cases, they went ahead and started integration with no interference from anybody. For some reason in Tuskegee, we now have another governor. Governor Wallace is governor. They had made plans, and the community had done a good job of making plans to integrate, only to wake up on the day of the schools to find out that Governor Wallace had sent state troopers to surround the school and prevent integration. So there we are. What do we do? I said in my own mind that if the governor has the power to close one school to prevent integration, he has the power to be ordered to integrate all the schools, if that's the law of the land. So I said, well, let's amend the complaint. We file an amended supplemental complaint. Name Governor Wallace as a defendant. Name the state superintendent as a defendant. Named all the members of the State Board of Education as defendant. Set out what had happened specifically at Macon County. And then alleged and cited all of the state statutes which gives all of the control about publicly schools in the hands of the superintendent of the state board. And believe it or not, and then asked that a three-judge court be convened, because we are now talking about some statewide orders, as we were talking about a statewide order in Browder versus Gale. They started out as single cases. At first, the court ruled that they agreed with what I was saying about what the law is and that they had the authority to do it. And they entered an order saying that we have the authority to do this. But it is such a far-reaching order that we will not exercise that, and we will hope that the state officials will abide by the law, because the governor went ahead and did whatever he wanted to do. Finally, in I think about 1967, I again renewed my motion, and the court entered a statewide order in which, in this one case, while we used to have to go and file a separate suit in each case, in each school system, and then we had about 121, I think, at that time, probably have more than that now. The court ordered the superintendent to compel every school system not then under court order to come forth with a plan to integrate.
And the court was Judge Johnson?
Well, he was a part of the three-judge panel. Okay. It was a three-judge panel now doing this, because we have a statewide order involved, a statewide law involved. And not only that, but at that time, the State Board of Education had under its control several other institutions of higher learning. It didn't have Auburn in Alabama, but it did have Troy State, Alabama State, A&M, and several others.
All the trade schools.
Well, that's another part of it. But even the senior colleges, which did not have a separate board, was ordered integrated. And all of the schools under the trade schools and junior colleges were ordered. The athletic association was ordered. The faculty of all of them were ordered. So it was a statewide order of unlike anything else. Now you have, instead of one lawsuit, you have over 100 lawsuits because you had 99 school systems. Then you had these other institutions And you had these trade schools, and you had the whole question of faculty and staff being desegregated. And we kept that going for a while, and then the three-judge court decided that this is more than they wanted to do. And so they dismissed the three-judge court because they have now finished dealing with the statewide order and sent these cases to the respective district courts where they belong in the northern, middle, and southern districts. Those cases that we started in 1963, when Stanley that we talked about was just being born, basically, they are still, some of them are still pending in this court before Judge Thompson and Judge Albritton and maybe the other judge on some of the others, because no final unitary order has been entered 35 years later.
Could we talk a little bit more about Carr versus Montgomery? Because that was some years later, and went to the Supreme Court in 1969. And tell us about how that case talked about affirmative action way back then.
Before I get to affirmative action, I was really disappointed with the first year of Carr versus Montgomery County Board of Education, because Mrs. Carr was the lead plaintiff, and she was one of the founders of the Montgomery Improvement Association that worked with us in the movement. And we felt that if anybody's child was entitled to a desegregated education, she would be one. But under the pupil placement law, Judge Johnson permitted them to reassign Alan Carr to the school he had been attending that first year. And he had his little mind set on going to Lanier. Lanier was the thing then. But after that, the next year he was assigned to Lanier and then later on finished it. But I really think that there are some who believe that that was a part of the reprisal and to try to give the folks something, so at least we didn't let her go in first. But in any event, that's what happened on it. The other thing, 4 or 5 years after Levy-Macon, 4 or 5 years after the Carr case was moving along rather well, what we had done, and let me go back and put this in because it was very important. I observed early on that we were deciding the rights of students. And in some instances, in order for the student rights to be decided, there were faculty rights that had to be decided. But there was nobody there really representing the faculty. So on behalf of the then Black Teacher Association, Alabama State Teachers Association, I filed a motion for leave to intervene on behalf of the Black teachers so that as the rights of teachers and administrators are being decided, they would be adequately represented. So you'll notice that they were added. And then when ASTA merged with AEA, and I worked on that merger, we didn't want to upset the apple cart there, but yet we needed to have an organization still there representing teachers. So we ended up substituting NEA instead of ASTA when it merged with the Alabama Education Association. What I observed in Carr was that we were getting students integrated, but we still had all Black and all white faculty and principals and coaches. So I came up and submitted to the court and said, well, why don't we integrate these faculty and staff? And one way to do it is to have the same ratio of faculty in the various schools as you have their race, and set some goals and some timetables. Because one way to measure the achievement is find out how many you have over a certain period of time. Judge Johnson bought the argument. It went up to the United States Supreme Court, and the United States Supreme Court affirmed it. And what you really had was numerical goals and timetables, which later developed into what people call affirmative action. And the precedent for all of it is Carr versus the Montgomery County Board of Education. And many people don't know that.
You were going in so many different areas. I call your attention to what you were doing in the area of farm services for African Americans. Do you recall the case of James H.M. Henderson versus ASCS?
I do. There's a lot of questions now about farmers, and unfortunately, I wasn't involved in representing any of the farmers on this go-round. But currently in the news is the fact that black farmers all over the nation have been discriminated in connection with particularly loans. But they've been discriminated against on all substitutes. And we discovered that as early as, what was that, about 1968. And the county, I think they call it Agricultural Stabilization Committee, is the one in each of these counties that decide who gets what as far as farm substitutes are concerned. And there had been no African Americans serving on any of the committees. And the way the thing works is you have the county committee, but the county committee is elected by committeemen in the various communities throughout the county. And they had just completely ignored black farmers. We filed the suit and ultimately obtained an order in which they held that there was discrimination in the farm substitutes. And the basis of that order, the whole agricultural department completely reorganized itself. And we had the first members of county committees serving in Macon County and the first chairman of a ASCS committee in this state and in the nation, African American, started there. Dr. Henderson was one of the instructors at Tuskegee, and he was also a farmer. And he was one of the lead plaintiffs in that case. And Otis Pinkert, who was quite an activist in Macon County, was the first county chair of the ASCA committee.
When we were talking about education cases, we talked about your venture into student rights and teacher rights. And I'll just mention that you also went in the area of recreation. I noticed Gilmore versus Montgomery, where you integrated the parks, and that went up to the Supreme Court.
Yeah, that was a case that Saul and I worked on. As you know, Solomon Say was a law partner of mine for many, many years. Unfortunately, he's quite ill now, but we were law partners for about 25 or so years. And he was counsel of record in many of these cases that I've talked about. And in my book, Bus Ride to Justice, I name every lawyer who was counsel of record on both sides. And I'm just adding this in. You didn't ask for it. But the civil rights movement and the historians have almost ridden lawyers out of the movement altogether. They talk about the demonstrations. They talk about the marches. They talk about the speeches. But that's not what changed things. What changed the landscape in this nation is the orders primarily coming from the bench of this court by Judge Johnson and by other federal judges across the nation. And without those orders, the marches and the speeches would have been of no avail. While they were good to get public opinion, they were good to help in getting support for the passage of legislation later on, but the real hardcore issues were those decisions.
Can you tell us about Pilate versus the United States of America?
That's 72, but you're missing one other education case that I think is important.
Tell us about it, please.
That is Alabama State Teachers Association versus the Alabama College and University College Authority, and that may be its ASTRA. What happened was in 1968 or 69, there were some people who wanted a college in Montgomery for whites, is what it really amounts to. There were some people who wanted to have a college in Montgomery for white folks. They knew that they couldn't exclude blacks, but Alabama State had been here for almost 100 years. Instead of taking the resources that they could have taken and developed Alabama State into what it should have been, they wanted to have a separate school so that whites would be able to attend. Now, it wasn't going to exclude blacks. At the time, University of Alabama had an extension office here. They had some classes out on Bell Street. They tried to get the University of Alabama interested in having a branch office in campus in Montgomery, and they would not. They then went to Auburn, and Auburn University agreed that they would sponsor a Auburn University in Montgomery. And the legislature passed legislature authorizing the establishment of it and bonds to float it. I filed a suit, and I ended up getting Morris Dees, who at this time now has become very active in this area, to work with me on it. He had gotten me to work with him on a case against the YMCA some years before. And I felt that I needed some white person working with me on this case who could probably find out some information from the white community that I knew I would not get. Plus, he was also a good lawyer and one who was doing work in the civil rights field, and he did agree to work with us, and we worked very hard on it. And that's one of the cases we lost. Judge Johnson ruled against us. We went up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court would not review it. And I think as we look back over it, if we could have gotten this court in the latter part of the 60s to have entered an order enjoining the building of AUM here in Montgomery, I think it would have changed the whole course of higher education in this state. Because once it was approved here for Auburn to have a university in Montgomery, then the university, while they weren't interested in here, they were interested in Huntsville. So they then go and have a branch in Huntsville, right in the back door to Alabama A&M, who had been there all the time. And the whole business and what we went into was perpetuating a dual system of higher education in the 60s when it should not have existed. Auburn and Montgomery should never have been built. If those resources, if they didn't like where Alabama State was, they could have closed that down, built a whole new campus over where they went or wherever they wanted it to go. And up at the University of A&M, they should have done the same thing. If that had happened, then there would have been no need for Knight versus the state of Alabama, which came along years later, which held as late as 1994. And even since then, that there is still discrimination in higher education. So we really lost it, and I think if the court had wanted to, there was enough precedent, and there was enough other cases and the court had analyzed situations in other cases to the extent that we could have won Astra case, and it would have changed not only the whole complexion in this state, but in the whole nations. Because the case over in Mississippi was a similar situation that would never have arisen if we could have gotten it straight here.
And before we wrap up the education cases, we didn't mention, but these are cases that are very well known to the public, Vivian Malone and Jimmy Hood versus University of Alabama that you handled in the 70s, and to integrate the University of Alabama, where Governor Wallace had his stand, and also Franklin versus Auburn University, where you integrated Auburn University back in the 60s.
Yeah, I have filed, I guess, suits that have integrated all of the institutions of higher learning in the state in connection with the University of Alabama. If you remember, Arthurine Lucy was admitted in before I was a member of the bar, but she was expelled. And the same year that I filed these elementary and secondary school cases I talked about, we also filed the case of Vivian Malone versus the University of Alabama. And it resulted in permanently opening those doors. And of course, the governor had his infamous schoolhouse stand, but they've opened the doors of the university, and now the university is one of the universities in this nation that has a very large amount of African Americans enrolled, particularly in the Birmingham campus. And then from there we went to Franklin. Franklin had gone to Alabama State, and he wanted to go to graduate school at Auburn. And Auburn would not admit him, so we had to file that case in order to integrate Auburn. And even another one involving Auburn related really to employment. That's the Strain case. Strain was in employment working with the Extension Service, and they discriminated against him in employment. And one of your early cases was Strain versus Auburn University, and that case is still around. And Fred Jr. is working with it. Saul was working on it, and recently Fred is working on that.
I asked you to share with us who was the oldest person or oldest relative you knew, and you told me your mom, and I never followed up on that. How old did your mother live to be?
Oh, she was 97 when she passed.
And so that was why you, yes. That was your answer. Then another thing, when you were telling me about the honeymoon between you, with you and your wife, that was cut short because you had gotten some papers about the draft. So let me ask you now about your military service.
Oh, because I've never had any military service. Let me tell you what happened. As I indicated to you much at the beginning of this interview, I was always interested in the ministry. And as a matter of fact, I was a minister long before I was a lawyer. And when I registered for the draft, I indicated what I was doing, and I was a student at the time. I also indicated that I was a minister. I was classed in a minister's classification, which, if I'm remembering correctly, I think it was 4D. And I would get a letter either annually or every year or two asking about what I was doing. I would respond to that truthfully and tell them when I was a student, I was a student, but I also indicated what my ministerial functions were. And at all times, I still performed ministerial functions when I was a student. For example, at Case Western, I became the assistant minister of the then East 100th Street Church of Christ, which is now the University Church in Cleveland. And when I finished, every year I get the annual report about my status. I tell them what I'm doing, and I did that. And the draft board was perfectly satisfied, apparently until the bus boycott started. And I was, of course, interested. I was representing parties in it. And one of the newspaper persons who worked for the afternoon paper in Montgomery inquired about my status or something about the draft. Anyway, I told him what was truthful. And he then decided to investigate into my draft situation. He found out that I had a minister's classification. And there was an article in the local papers. And as a result, the draft boards immediately summarily reclassified me to 1A. And it was based on that reclassification that they were ordering that I immediately report for induction, or immediately report to be examined, because I got back from the honeymoon, I was examined, because physically I was all right, and later received greetings telling me that I should report for induction. There was an appeal process once they officially changed my draft status, and I appealed it, and it went all the way up to General Hershey, who at that time was director of Selective Service. And it was only I had orders to report for induction like tomorrow morning at 8, and I received a wire from him, from the state officer, telling me that my induction into service had been postponed based on orders from General Hershey. Now, if they had reclassified me either while I was a student or when I started practicing, based on the annual report, I would have had no objections to going ahead and going in service. As a matter of fact, I had checked into several things about getting a commission, and I was prepared for that to happen. But what I did not want the draft board to do was to be satisfied with what my status was. And if I had not handled any civil rights cases, they would never have complained. But to use the fact that I was representing people in the field of civil rights, and because of that, to get rid of me and use the draft for that purpose, that's what I objected to. And that's what that scenario is all about.
Tell us about how you got involved with the Tuskegee Syphilis Study.
Well, I guess my involvement in that case was just about like the average way that lawyers become involved in cases, or should become involved. The first I heard about the Tuskegee syphilis was a few days earlier. I was coming from Washington, been there for something, back, and on the plane I had gotten the newspaper and I was reading this story about the Tuskegee syphilis study and something that had happened in Macon County, going on for some time, and I thought I knew most of what was going on in the county. So I came on to the office, and a day or so later, Mr. Charlie Pollard came into my office. I think it was probably the 27th of July in 72. And he had a copy of the local paper, which I had already read. And he told me who he was, and of course I knew Mr. Pollard because he owned property up in Notasulga, and I had done a little deed or so in the past. And he told me that he understand that he is a newspaper story. I'm one of the persons who was involved in it, and wanted to know whether or not he thought that the government had taken advantage of them because they didn't know that they were in the study. Didn't know anything about syphilis, and it was only brought to his attention the day or so before, when he was at a stockyard down here in Montgomery selling cows, that a newspaper person found him and started asking him about it, and he wanted to know if I could do something about it. We sat down, we talked quite a bit, and he told me about some other persons who were involved in the study, and from there, that was the beginning of it, and it has been going on from that day until this day. When I finish our interview here today, I'll talk with the clerk, and we're in the process of trying to disburse some final interest on some proceeds that in the case that we settled back in 1975 or 76.
Could you just share a little bit about the background of the syphilis study? I know that case was Charlie Pollard versus United States of America.
Yes, well, what happened in 1932, well, if you go back a little before 1932, in the late 20s, there was quite a bit of syphilis that was going on in the country, and it had, some of it had been identified. And there were some of these nonprofit groups who were interested in trying to cure syphilis. Of course, the way they treated syphilis then was pretty crude compared to the way it's treated now. So there was a treatment program that was in existence in the late 20s in Macon County. And there were similar programs in about four or five other basically southern states where they had found a substantial amount of syphilis. But this particular organization decided that they would discontinue their treatment program. And there were some doctors connected with the Public Health Service who knew about the area where they exactly where these people were in these various counties and knew the work that that foundation had been doing in connection with treating syphilis. So some of them came up with the idea of having a, utilizing the information that this foundation had in terms of contact with persons who had syphilis, and they would have, initially it came up as a short term study to see what would be the effect of untreated syphilis. Fortunate or unfortunate, all the persons they were dealing with, I think unfortunately, were African Americans. And they were basically farmers. Most of them lived in and around Macon County. Few of them lived in the city of Tuskegee itself. They were basically rural individuals. And there appeared in the black rural community of Macon County an announcement saying that they're inviting persons to come to a certain church or a certain school at a certain date, that there was a health program and they may be interested in. And when these people went, including in the case of Mr. Pollard, who went to the Shiloh School, which was right up the road from where he lived in Notasoga, there were two persons basically who were there. A Dr. Smith, who was the public health officer in Macon County, and he was white. And Mrs. Rivers, who was a black nurse in Macon County. They talked about a health program that would be for men, that doctors would come, would examine them, and wanted to know if they would participate. They didn't ask them to sign up. They didn't give them anything to read about it. They didn't tell them that it was, in fact, a study. So it developed that they would, every 6 months or so, have blood tests, examine the men. And then after about a few years, they decided that the information they had was very valuable in their sight, and that they could not really do the work as a short-term project. So they decided to make it, to expand it as a lifelong program designed to have two groups, a group that had syphilis and a group that did not have syphilis, that was called control. These were men living in the same community. Working conditions were about the same. Their living conditions were about the same. And they wanted to observe them and examine them and study them through their lifetimes and then at their death they would have autopsies performed. And by doing that, they would end up having what they call the results of untreated syphilis. And that was basically how it started. Now, it wasn't really a secret to people who were very in the medical profession, who knew about syphilis and who were very concerned about it, because there were several published reports that had been made over a period of time talking about these men. But the study did not become generally known until a story was broken in 1972 with reference to it. And that really started by a employee in the Public Health Service all the way out in San Francisco who had seen copies of these reports, a fellow named Peter Buxton. And Peter was concerned, and he complained to his supervisors about these men and couldn't understand why they were being treated that way. And this, of course, was after penicillin had become available. And he continued to complain. They finally arranged for him to go to Atlanta to CDC, which was the public health program that was operating and financing the study, and he talked to people over there. They tried to satisfy his curiosity, but they never did anything about it. He finally told a newspaper person out in the San Francisco area, who contacted a newspaper person in the D.C. area, who wrote a story about what happened, and that's when it became generally public in 1972.
And were you able to finally bring some closure in recent years for the men in this case?
Well, this case was a difficult case. It was unlike most of the cases I had had, except for the farm case, because most of my cases had been against state municipal entities. And the only federal one really we were concerned basically with was the agricultural case and Dr. Henderson. But this was a case where the federal government, the one that we had been going to protect us, was really the corporation that was financing, sponsoring the whole thing. So I realized that this was a major undertaking, and I needed some help. There was a couple of things I needed. I needed, one, some good research and persons who could help me with the pleading and help me with doing briefs, because I knew if I was going to file the case in this court, I kind of understood Judge Johnson, and I know that he'd like briefs, and he doesn't give you a whole lot of time to get them together. So I needed to have somebody or somebodies who would be in a position to give me the research support that I would need. I also realized once you start dealing with the federal government and dealing with a study that was as long as this one, just the plain research and trying to find experts and that sort of thing was going to be very difficult. So I needed somebody who could finance the case. I needed somebody who could give us the research. I went to the normal sources that had helped me in the past, the NAACP and the League Defense Fund. And they were concerned about it, but says, well, it has the potential of being a fee-generated case. And since that's the case, then we really should not get involved in it. I wrote several law firms across the country to try to find one that would be willing to do both things. I was unable to do so. So finally, I decided I was going to have to do it on my own, but I did. I was able to find some law professors up at Columbia who was willing to do and to assist me with the research. They would not be counsel of record in it, but they would assist me when I would need some research, and they could do it, and I had students there who would be able to do it. Then I went to, that took care of my research aspect. That still didn't take care of the financial aspect, because these civil rights cases in those days didn't pay very much, and that was before you had before you could get a fee if you were on the prevailing side. So I went over and talked to my banker, Mr. J.A. Parker, president of the Alabama Exchange Bank, discussed with him the situation. He said, well, lawyer, the bank can lend you some money and can wait until you kind of know what's going to happen to your case, but we can't do it on a continued fee basis that you're going to have to pay the bank back. I said, well, I didn't think you would do it on a continued fee basis. And but they did agree to lend me whatever money I needed in order to finance the case. So with that in place, because we now have been doing all the investigation, ended up, and it was a mammoth job because you had a lot of these men now long since left the South. Many of them were even dead, and just the sheer responsibility of just interviewing people to try to find out who was involved. You start off with nobody, and of course later as things developed and once we got to a point where we got a settlement and there was some money involved, then everybody was related. But one of the real problems, we had a lot of legal problems on it. We had statute of limitation problems. We had, you know, under the suit, whether it's going to be under the Federal Tort Claims Act or some other act, and you can only sue the government in situations where they permit you to sue them, and then under the conditions that they say you can sue. So we had a lot of restraints because of the government that we would not have had if it had been a private corporation that had engaged in this type of activity. But as we got into the discovery aspect of it, and we really needed to know how the study started. My clients didn't know. And I didn't have anybody we could go to. We did know that the Public Health Service must have known about it. And particularly, we also knew that in the 40s, when penicillin became available, the law was that anybody who had syphilis, they had to treat them for it. But yet, these men were not being treated. When I received the response to my discovery, the government said, well, we don't have any records. We know that the study exists. We know it's been going on since 32. But those old records, which would show how it started up until the mid-40s, we simply don't know where they are. Well, if they don't know where they are, how do you find them? Well, sometime you go as far as you can go and then things happen. One day, I was sitting in my office and I received a phone call. And this party on the other end says that my name is Jim Jones, so you don't know me, but I understand you represent these men in Tuskegee Syphilis Study. I said, I do. And he says, well, I've been interested in that study for many years. He's a historian, a medical historian. And that he had been trying to find those old records for a long time. But he says, I have found them, and I'll make them available to you if you'll come to Washington. I caught the first thing I could get going to Washington. And sure enough, he had located those original records, many of them handwritten records, of how the study started, and he had found them in the National Archives, scattered throughout 400 and some unmarked boxes. They were just there. And that was really the beginning. And once we were able to make those records available to the government in terms of moving along the case, they then indicated that maybe we ought to see if we can't settle this matter. And that was the settlement process. Once we ended up settling the case, in the meantime now, the study, for all practical purposes, have been discontinued. I had this Senator Kennedy was very interested in it, and one of the outfalls of it was he had a health committee, and I accompanied four of our participants up who testified. And one thing as a result of it, that was legislation passed which now prohibits using human beings the way these persons were used. And that's one of the legacies of this study. But back on the financial aspect, when we started, we had to then find. And at one point during the litigations, the court entered an order that I could only, as far as deceased persons were concerned, the only persons who had standing was personal representatives. But now I had not gone out and tried to have administrations on about 300 and some estates. But my order told me and gave me a certain designated time that I had to have that done. And when the time came by, believe it or not, we had opened over 300 and some administrations. And even the court was shocked that it had been done. I think they expected me to come back and ask to be relieved of that responsibility, but we did it and got it done.
Now, the legislation that you talked about what year was the legislation with Senator Kennedy's?
It probably was in the 70s when that legislation was passed.
And then just in the last few years, what closure has been brought?
Well, of course, we had the matter of finding the folks, then we had to pay them and find the heirs, pay them, then there was interest on interest, so that has been going on for years. And about 3 years ago, there was a question came up that maybe we ought to try to get the federal government to apologize to these people. And there was some group that started, and then when I heard about it and when we saw this Ms. Elva's boys, I had some of the participants in the study to come in and see it and talk with them, and they told me, one, that Ms. Elva's boys was not an accurate depiction of what they were involved in, and two, they would be in favor of having the government make an apology to them. But in addition to an apology, they said, what they would like to have in Tuskegee, in the city of Tuskegee, a permanent memorial. A memorial that will not only acknowledge their contributions, but the contributions that other ethnic groups have made in the field of human and civil rights. To make a long story short, we had a press conference at the Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church where Mr. Pollard was recruited on April 8, 1997. We were able to get about 40 or 50 national media people there. We had five or six of the participants. They told about their involvement, told what they wanted done. And before the close of day on that day, the White House announced that they were going to make an apology. We then began to work with the White House on having the kind of apology that we thought would be representative of these men. And on the 16th of May of 1997, they were invited, the living participants and the heirs of some of the deceased participants were invited to the White House. They got a chance to meet the president and the vice president and the surgeon general, who was later to be surgeon general. And the president did make an apology. He made that apology after one of the spokesmen, Mr. Herman Shaw, made a speech and again told the president that they had started then the Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center in Tuskegee as the permanent memorial for those men.
And it was President Clinton.
Yes. And that organization was incorporated almost 3 years ago. So as a result of that, you have several other legacies of the study. Of course, we do have, and subsequent to setting up the nonprofit corporation, the purpose of which is to have, to educate the people, the public, and to have a center and a museum showing the contributions of the various ethnic groups in central Alabama in the field of human and civil rights. Contributions made by Native Americans, contributions made by Americans of European descent, and contributions made by Americans of African descent at one place. And the Alabama Exchange Bank has given to the center a building in downtown Tuskegee. And while the center is not open, we've had several functions on it, and we'll have another function next month celebrating the third anniversary. We think it is going to be a real major step toward healing the wounds, where you can see at one place the various contributions that the various groups have made in the field. Another part of that legacy is also that the Tuskegee University was given a grant to establish a bioethics center.
Now, that multicultural center, that's the name of the center?
The Tuskegee Human, the Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center. The Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center.
And it's located where?
It's located in downtown Tuskegee on Elm Street, just a block and a half from the courthouse.
While you have handled many cases, we have talked about a few of your major cases, and are there any other major cases that you've handled that I've not asked you about that you want to share with us?
Probably a lot of them. I'm just trying to think of some that you may be interested in. Of course, I told you we didn't start the litigation but was involved in the Knight case. Because one of the more recent cases we were involved in was defending some of the legislators in the redistricting case. Alabama have come almost full circle in the sense that at one time we had no registered voters now and no black or African American public officials. We now lead the nation as one of the largest number of African Americans in most states. We're probably second or third in the nation on that score. And in our legislature, 25% of the members are African American, and that's about what our population is. And that came as a result of negotiations really between black leaders and white leaders and coming up with what they could live with a state circuit judge approving a plan which was ultimately approved by the Alabama Supreme Court, which is a far cry from what the Alabama Supreme Court used to do in these racial cases. But there was some white litigants who didn't like the composition of the legislature, and they filed suits in this court. And just, I think it was in January, we tried.
January of what year?
2000. Mm-hmm. 2000, either January or February of 2000. We tried the case for about 7 or 8 days in this courtroom. The purpose we were defending in that case, because they were trying to set aside this order and have new elections, and it was a 3-judge district court. The court ended up, while it has not reached a final decision in the case, they did decide they were not going to order any new elections, and that matter is under submission. So that is one of the latest cases that we're handling. It's also involved in the teacher testing case, which was a case started back in 85. My former law partner, Solomon Say, was involved in it initially, and when he became incapacitated a year or so ago, we became involved in that case, and we recently settled it. So those are two of the more recent cases. Of course, there are a lot of other civil rights cases that we probably have handled that if you really want to read about it, read The Bus Ride to Justice, and quite a few of them are set out in there.
And since you mentioned that, what is Bus Ride to Justice?
Bus Ride to Justice really is a book, copy of which I think I have over here, which is my autobiography, but it is really more than that. It is a history of the civil rights movement, beginning basically with Rosa Parks, but going back on some of the events as far back as the beginning of the doctrine of separate but equal under Pleasant versus Ferguson, and bringing it up to date to about 2 or 3 years ago.
When did you author that book?
The book was published in 1995. It was published in 1995. Yeah.
And have you written any other books?
Yes, I've written. In Bus Ride to Justice, there is a chapter 17, that deals with the Tuskegee Syphilis Study. But the Tuskegee syphilis study has had so many twists and turns of its own, and while it's a highly specialized area, there are some people who have a particular interest in that study. So we thought I should at least write a book setting forth these men's position and how they felt and what happened to them from their point of view, and that's what the Tuskegee syphilis study is. Because Jim Jones wrote a book, Bad Blood, which is a very good book. It's more of a historical study, and it indicates how he found the records that I told you about earlier and the details of that. But it does not discuss from the men's point of view how they felt and what their reaction is. And that's what we try to do in the Tuskegee syphilis study.
And when did you author that book?
That one was published in 1997.
Have you found any special challenges to private practice?
Well, private practice itself is a challenge. I guess if you grow up doing something, it is not as bad as if you were to have a job where you can work from 8 to 5 and you know you're going to get a salary whether you have any billable hours or not. But private practice is a very challenging part of the law, because if you don't get out and earn it, you don't make it. And there are many individuals who simply are not equipped to do it. Plus, the demands are much greater than if you are able to get in a situation where you're guaranteed a paycheck and you can just do so much work and then go home and it's all over till the next day.
You know, I have not asked you about, but I know while in private practice, you have found the time to be a candidate for the legislature and have been elected to the legislature. Could I have a brief comment about that?
Yeah, I have always been interested in the legislature. When I was living in Montgomery, and one of the reasons I moved to Tuskegee, it really was twofold. One was I was interested in becoming a member of the Alabama legislature, and at that time I did not see any seats in Montgomery where they would have elected me, the former civil rights lawyer, to the Alabama legislature, and there were not single member districts. You were really almost running at large at that time. There was a district in northeast of here, well, east basically, consisting of Macon County, Bullock County, and Barber County. And then there were two seats for those three counties. And I had done legal work in all three of those counties, because when I first met Governor George Wallace, it was in Bullock County on a case. And then I had a series of cases with him down in Barber County. And I'd done a lot of work in Macon. So I thought it would be a good place for me to go to try to start a political career.
When did you move to Macon?
I moved to Macon in 1964.
Okay.
In addition to that, I also looked at my practice. And I was, at this point, getting a lot of clients from Tuskegee and Macon County. Well, that had happened ever since I opened my door. But I could foresee if we ever were able to get the vote, we could have a kind of practice in Tuskegee that I could not at that time have in Montgomery. So for those two reasons, I moved my family to Macon. I didn't want to live in Montgomery County and just drive over there to practice law. I wanted to be a part of the community, and that's what we did. I ran for the legislature in 1965, and from those three counties, and when it was all over, it indicated that I was a winner. Matter of fact, there was an article that appeared the next day in the New York Times and throughout the nation. But later on that day, they said that the votes, the absentee ballots in Barber County had not been counted. And when they were counted, instead of me winning by 300 votes, I lost by 300 votes. Well, I didn't like it, and I thought the race was really stolen from me. I'd been told by a white banker down in the southern part of Barber County before that election, he said, well, Fred, I think you could make a good representative, and I was running for a seat in the House. He said, but you know, we've been stealing elections down here from each other, and you can imagine what will happen to you. And that is exactly what I believe happened in connection with that. But in addition to that, we had several other black candidates who were running, and really a lot of them were able to get elected because they didn't have the three counties to deal with. For example, Lucius Amberson was running for the sheriff of Macon County, and he ran against the best wishes of the black community. But he was running with me when I was running, and he ended up getting elected because all he had to do was deal with Macon. Same thing was true of Red Williams, who was running for sheriff down in Bullock County. So while we, now I think in that instance, he may or may not have won that race, but particularly in Bullock, they felt that there were a lot of improper and illegal conduct. So a suit was filed. I filed a suit, Fred D. Mann and others versus the judge of probate, who was Mann at the time, of Bullock County. And that case was tried here. So I'll say my law partner represented me in that case. We put up a good battle, but we didn't win the case. However, 4 years later, I ran again, and I did win, and I became one of the first, well, the first Democratic nominee to the Alabama House of Representatives. And of course, there were two seats, Tom Reed and I became the first blacks to serve in the Alabama legislature since Reconstruction.
And along with your illustrious career as a lawyer, did you put forth yourself for nomination for the bench?
Well, what happened in 1980, probably in 79, we had a unique opportunity in Alabama. One of our senators died, and I think another one retired. So we elected, during one of our elections, two U.S. senators, which was highly unusual. And one of those was Senator Heflin, and the other one was Senator Stewart from up in North Alabama. Incidentally, both of them were from North Alabama. And the black community, headed then by ADC, and Joe Reed was the chairman, indicated that and we received commitments from both of the senators, that they would want two African-American lawyers to be on the federal bench in the state of Alabama. And these senators made that commitment to them. And they were elected. And the margin of victory was really the black vote in the state. And they nominated, the senators did, UW Clemens of Birmingham, and nominated me. So, and I suspect our hearings, and particularly my hearing, was probably the longest hearing that any judicial nominee had had before probably Justice Thomas to the U.S. Supreme Court. And I went to Washington, I don't know how many times, and I know for hearings it was some three times.
What years are we talking about?
We're talking about 1980, probably the first part of 1980, and it started really back in, I think, 79. But the long shot of it is the, because once my name surfaced, there was a lot of opposition that came up. But there was nothing that came up during the hearings that we were not aware of, or that our senators were not aware of, even before they had indicated their support. And both of them made supporting statements to both of our candidates. And finally, in my particular case, for reasons best known to our senator, he decided that he would get off of the nomination. And I had enough sense to know that if the senator got off of it, I wouldn't make it. But I did want to be sure that the senators didn't get off of the fact that they were committed to the black community to end up recommending a lawyer for the bench of the selection of the black community. And
what bench?
The one of the vacancies was the United States District Court for the Middle District. This particular judgeship that Judge Frank M. Johnson, who at that time had gone on up to the 11th Circuit. So this court. And the other one was in the Northern District. UW Clemens ultimately was confirmed and became the first African-American federal judge to sit in the state of Alabama, and no since Reconstruction. But I had an understanding with the White House, because I didn't want our senators to get off the hook, that I would not withdraw my name as a candidate. And this was when President Carter was in office, and the president indicated that he was not going to withdraw my name unless I requested it. And to make a long story short, I wanted to be sure that there was another African-American who was committed and who would become the United States District Judge for this district. When I had that assurance, I withdrew my name. And few weeks later, the Honorable Myron Thompson was recommended by our senators for the judgeship here. And Senator Heflin took him around to all of the senators up on the Hill, and he was confirmed in less than a 30-minute hearing. And I'm just delighted that he was confirmed, and he asked that I make remarks at his when he was sworn in, and I did. And predicted that he might go ahead one of these days to become on the Court of Appeal, even the United States Supreme Court. Who knows?
Can you tell us about the, or just give us the names of the cadre of fine lawyers that have come to work
with
you? Yeah,
well, I have had the privilege of inviting many of the outstanding lawyers in this state. I've been in our office, and I've had something to do with their growth and development. The first one was Solomon Sir. And I felt a debt of an obligation to his father, because his father, as I told you earlier, Reverend Say, had really helped me when I started. And when his son finished some couple of years later, I asked him if he would join my office, and he practiced with me for a substantial period of time. A few years later, his sister became a doctor here, Hagelin Say, and then Saul moved out on Jeff Davis, and he shared an office with his sister. And some years after that, we invited him back, and then for 25 or more years, we practiced together. And many of the cases I've talked with you about here today have been cases that he has worked with me on and have been a real moving force in all of that. In addition to Solomon, say, Billy Carter, who's an outstanding lawyer here in Montgomery. Actually, Billy practiced with me on two separate occasions. Right after he finished law school, he practiced basically out of the Tuskegee office. And then he went in military service and came back and practiced with us. Then after he practiced with us, Don Watkin, that a lot of us know all about now, a rather high-profile lawyer. Don had finished law school and was working as administrative assistant to Dr. Matthews at the University of Alabama. And I was invited over to the law school once to make a speech. And Don came to hear me, and after the speech, he took me to his office, and his office was right next to the president, and copied on the floor that thick, and had all these little secretaries with short dresses running around. And I looked at him, and I said, Donald, if you ever want to practice law, you better get out of this situation. And every time they get ready to go to Washington, they put him on the university's jet plane and take him up there. And we discussed what I thought he was by his conduct. And he resigned his position and came and started practicing law with us. He practiced out of the Montgomery office directly with Solomon Say for 3 or 4 years. And then Don Watkin and Billy Carter left, and they formed their firm here in Montgomery. In addition to that, we also had Troy Massey was with us, and Tyrone Mean. Both of them, their first private practice was as a member of our firm. And then they later left and formed their own firm. And Terry Davis was working then, I think, for NEA, and he came and worked with us for a while. And Theron Stokes, who was a young man who had grown up in the church that I was the minister of here in Montgomery, the Newtown Church of Christ. At the time, I was doing all of the work for the boycott, and up from 1956 until 1972. I was just looking at a scrapbook night before last that church had given me for the years of service that I performed, and many of the young people out at the Newtown Church, and that's out at Newtown between the railroads where nothing good supposed to have come, and we were able to take and give some encouragements to youngsters out there. Out of that group, we produced doctors and lawyers and principals of schools and school administrators, church officials, preachers, elders, deacons, just good folks. And I was able to do that working with those people at the same time I was doing this work. In addition to that, back on your lawyers,
there's a lawyer in New Orleans that comes to see you.
Yes, there is a lawyer, I'll think of his name in just a moment. I can't think of it right this minute, but he was originally from Macon County, lived in the Notasauga area. And then there's another one up in Minnesota, Parrish, Alfreda Parrish. Alfreda was from Wilcox County and practiced with me as a law clerk. Had difficulty passing the Alabama bar, and he had finished the University of Iowa Law School. So finally, while he wanted to stay here and practice, since he couldn't get by the bar, he decided to go back to Iowa. He took the bar exam and passed it the first time he took it in Iowa. And he started out as a private practitioner. 2 months ago, I was invited to the university, to Iowa State University. And Alfreda now has an integrated law firm with offices in Des Moines and one other city in Iowa. Has about 12 lawyers there. And he is doing real well. In addition to his practice, he also has a son who is practicing with him there and a daughter who practices in Nashville. And he started it in our office. Because Charles Langford is probably the dean of black lawyers in the state of Alabama. He's been practicing longer than anyone else. And I think I'm probably the second oldest in terms of years of service. So Charles Langford is a member of our firm. There is a charming young lady named Ernestine Sapp, who was, I think, the first African-American female to finish Jones Law School. She came to Alabama with her husband, who's Dr. Sapp, and Dr. Sapp came down from Wisconsin to become a professor at Tuskegee University. And his wife came down with him along with their children. And among her many other things, she decided she wanted a second career. And she went to law school at Jones and is now and has been with our firm for over 15 years. And we're very happy to have her. She's a very hard-working lawyer and give me a hard way to go. But she is a very good, thorough lawyer and enjoys a good reputation in our state. And she is the first African-American to serve as a member of the Bar Commissioners of the state of Alabama. I happen to have been elected to that same position some 10 or 12 years ago as the first African-American to serve in that capacity. Then there is Walter McGowan. Walter McGowan is a lawyer. He's a native of Montgomery, has ties in Bullock of Macon County in Tuskegee, grew up there, went to Fisk University, and then he went to Temple. I talked with him. I represented his mother many, many years ago when he was being born, believe it or not. And when he was in high school, his mother brought him to me and told me that he wanted to talk with me. So I talked with Walter, and Walter wanted to be a lawyer. I did not know until his mother shared with me a few years ago. She said, you know, I really appreciate you talking to Walter a long time ago, but let me share something with you. When he came back, he told me that he enjoyed talking with me, but I just didn't give him enough time. So I guess that's one of the things we lawyers have to be a little careful when we're talking to people. We're usually pretty busy and don't always give them time. But Mr. Nixon had introduced me to his wife, and I mean to his mother, when she was employed at the VA hospital in Tuskegee. And at that time, she was having some difficulty on her job. And
this is Walter's mother.
This is Walter's mother, and this is E.D. Nixon, the same E.D. Nixon we talked about in the movement. And he wanted me to represent Walter's mother in connection with securing her job for her. And I did. I was able to do what she wanted done. And I ended up finding and sharing with Walter not too long ago a letter that I received from his mother in which she indicated that she was enclosing the last payment on my bill, and she was sorry it had taken so long, but she had just given birth to a baby boy, and his name was Walter. And to have Walter now as a part of our firm, he has a tremendous reputation throughout this whole state, both the plaintiff bar and the defense bar. And I guess one of the greatest tributes that a lawyer can have is when you're on the other side of a case, and then the lawyer will say, well, next time something comes up, I'd like to have you on my side. And that's the kind of lawyer that Walter McGowan is. In addition to that, we have my two sons, Fred Jr., who went to Morehouse to college and then to Howard Law School, and he's back with us and in his own right doing a very good job and practicing with us now for over 12 years. And the younger son, Stanley, who finished the University of Alabama undergraduate school, and he went to law school at Howard. He was Judge Tyson's law clerk when Judge Tyson was on the Court of Criminal Appeals, and is doing an outstanding job. Then the last, not last in terms of years of service, but Alan Nathanson, who is Jewish and who has practiced law in Tuskegee for over 30 years. Alan originally was from Arizona. He married a young lady from Alabama. Matter of fact, he married Harry Raymond's daughter, and Harry Raymond was one of the pioneer white lawyers in Tuskegee. And so after they married, Alan came and practiced with his father-in-law. And then later, Mr. Raymond had another son named Eddie who came and practiced, and the three of them practiced there together. And sometime later on, Mr. Raymond passed. And then Alan was talking with me one day and indicated that he and Eddie was going to part ways and wanted to know if he could come and practice with us. And I was just delighted to have him because he's probably the best tax and probate lawyer in our county, and he does an excellent job. So those are some of the lawyers, and I'm just happy that even the ones who they are now permit, they really have done a good job, and I'm just happy to work with them and glad to have them.
Can you explain or share with us the major professional organizations that you have been involved with?
Because professionally, I'm a member of the Alabama and Ohio bars. All of your federal bars in this state, including the the United States Supreme Court, all of the courts in the state of Alabama. I am a member of and have been for many years of the American Bar Association. I've served on some of its committees and received a few years ago its spirit forget the exact title of it, but it was an award they gave for a person who had made outstanding contributions in the field of civil rights. That was about 2 years ago. And I also served with them as a trial advisor, a trial observer to the treason trials in Liberia back in 1986. At the same time, I was president of the National Bar Association. I've been president of the National Bar basically ever since I've been a member, and have served as its president.
You were president of the National Bar in what year?
1985 and 1986.
But you have been active in the National Bar Association.
I've been active ever since I've been practicing. And I've been a member of the American Bar also about equal as long. I became members of both about the same time. And along with a lot of other professional organizations, including recently I was admitted to the American College of Trial Lawyers, which is a rather prestigious group. And just recently I was informed that I've been selected to become a member of the International Barristers Society. They only meet about once a year, and I should be sworn into that group when they meet next year.
And what about the state bar, the Alabama Bar Association?
Of course, we have an integrated bar, so the fact that you get a license make you a member. But I have served on various committees of the bar, and I told you earlier that I was the first African-American to serve on the Board of Bar Commissioners, which is the official governing body of the state bar.
Do you also serve with the Alabama Lawyers Association and the Montgomery Bar Association?
Yes, the Alabama Lawyers Association was formerly known as the Alabama Black Lawyers Association. At one time, while we were members, and this is true if you go back to years ago, black lawyers could not become members of the American Bar Association. It was for that reason, back in 1925, that the National Bar Association was founded. And while we are members of the Alabama Bar, I remember rather well there were times when we were not welcome into their meetings. And I remember rather well when Solomon Say's wife, Etra, wanted to go to one of the social functions of the state bar, and she was prohibited from going because the Alabama Lawyers Association was formed so that black lawyers would have some association between themselves that could help them grow and develop. And it still serves a useful function. I've served as one of the founders of it and also as one of its presidents.
Could you tell us what, if any, impact you think your rigorous role as a lawyer has had on your family life and social activities?
Well, the family life has been a very good experience. I guess if I go back and look at one of the good points about my not becoming a federal district judge is, well, probably a couple of things. The most important of which, if I had been, I would never have had the privilege of practicing law with my sons. And I have been able to help some lawyers, and to be able to help your own sons certainly help. And I say, I guess, secondly, prior to the time I was being considered for the judgeship, fees were very, very, economically, the practice had not been too well. And things have improved. So even when you're disappointed in some things, they have some rewards. And I think they were very great rewards.
Is there anything that you would do over or do differently?
Yes, if I could have my legal profession over, the one thing I would really do, I would devote more time and more effort to my family, because I had a very demanding type practice. But I did not have and did not devote as much time as I should have to the growth and development of our four children. And I think as lawyers grow and develop, they need to set aside some time for their families.
Is there any one person that you admire or would attribute most of your success in this illustrious career of yours?
I think if I go back and think about it, there are probably two persons, each serving a distinct role, that have been real instrumental in helping me develop into whatever I have developed into. First of all, I had a godly mother. Mom really took care of the five of us when we couldn't take care of ourselves, and she instilled within us basic principles. First of all, she told us that we were individuals made by God, and we needed to be Christians. And she insisted and brought us up in the church, and the religious activities that she has developed in me, I have instilled those principles in my children, and now I'm doing it in my grandchildren. So I'm really thankful to her. And then the other person who really served and helped to make me, I could not have done what I have done in the legal profession, not what I have done in the church, not what I've tried to do in community organizations, without my late wife, Bernice Hill Gray. I married Bernice right after she came out of high school. We had a good marriage for 40 years. She supported me in everything that I did. She was not a pushy type person out front. She was not one to be out there every day, but she was the pillar behind everything that I did. And she lived a full life. I'm only sorry that she is not here now and is not able to see some of the fruit and the benefit of her life and her work. But she still has it, as I said, in her funeral and my life and in the lives of our children. And she was just beginning to know her grandchildren. And as I go back and even think about that service, and that was a young lady who had worked in our office doing clerical work when she was a high school student, who came all the way for the family night from Detroit to talk about how Bernice had helped her grow and how she developed. And she was that type person. And I think any lawyer or any person, or certainly any man, he needs a real good, strong wife. And Bernice was that type of person. And she will continue to make contributions as time passes.
Mr. Gray, it's been a privilege and my delightful pleasure to interview you today. And on behalf of all of us, thank you.
Thank you very much. I've enjoyed it.